am I going to be a consumer today?
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim, Doc, Chris, and Nick responded to a listener letter about the corporate nature of E3. Plus, we celebrate our fourth birthday with lots of opening segments, including a traditional E3 edition of Buy, Try, or Trash. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners. Welcome to episode 132 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast. Games and new media with a splash of academia. I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Jim.
Hey, everybody.
And we're joined by Doc.
Hello, hello.
And we're joined by Nick.
Hello, hello.
And today is our birthday. We're having our birthday episode. Backward Compatible, the podcast, turns 4 years old today.
Happy birthday.
We're all grown up.
And to celebrate, we're having a bit of a birthday special. So we're going to be...
Wait just a minute. Hold on here. I thought we had a tradition that the newest cast member always brings a cake on our birthday. And Nick, I don't see a cake.
Eric's the newest cast member.
Well, he's not. Oh, that's why he's not here.
Yeah.
We have no cake.
So we will not eat it, too.
The cake was actually a lie, though. That's not true.
Chris, don't. Stop. Cut that out.
Cut that cake out.
So we're going to be doing a bit of a birthday special today. And in our tradition, we always talk about E3, talk about kind of our impressions from E3 this time of year. So this isn't the breaking news live from E3 sort of thing. This is more about we've had a couple weeks to process. We're going to talk about like kind of what stood out, what we paid attention to, what we didn't pay attention to.
My deeply cynical opinion.
Yes.
Yes, exactly.
Mainly that.
Yeah.
I've
never been an E3 person. I don't know.
It's going to be a bit of a longer show, too. We got lots of opening segments for you and then lots to talk about for E3. So hope you'll come along and enjoy the party with us. But first, we have some opening segments for you, including the Button Mosh.
Get ready for the Button Mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
Recently, I've picked up a PlayStation VR.
Condolences.
Well, actually, I had a sort of a preview of playing it from... I played it over at Chris's place at one point, and
yeah, I
played
some
other... Right, and I played some other VR, too, and I've been getting increasingly more interested in it. They're actually on sale currently, so I was able to pick one up along with a Skyrim bundle for about $100, I think, cheaper than normal. So I figured I'd go ahead and jump on board and try it out, and I did so, and I've honestly been pretty impressed. But the thing I want to talk about, and I don't want to go into all the different game experiences that I've had with it, I can at a later time, but I do want to talk about Skyrim VR. And the reason I do is because of a couple of reasons. So, actually, more than a couple. One is that I had a lot of experience, a lot of hours that I've sunk into the regular version of Skyrim on PC. Two is that pretty much at this point, just about everybody's played Skyrim on some system because it's been out for about 10 years.
Yeah, Skyrim VR is the fifth installment in the Skyrim series.
There you go, exactly. It's been all over the place.
I see what you did there, Nick.
But what I find interesting about it is that playing it in VR actually made the whole experience feel very different and new.
Isn't it?
I wasn't expecting. Yeah. I wasn't expecting that. And the thing that kind of clicked for me with VR, I had a very specific moment in Skyrim. So, for starters, when you first enter the game and you're escaping the dragon, it took me a little bit to get used to the feeling of movement, and I switched over to move controls pretty quickly because I'm still adjusting to the normal like stepping movement, so I'm using the teleportation currently until I get used to it more. I do like using the wands for swinging attacks or for casting magic spells especially. It's very satisfying. I went with a wizard character solely so I could cast spells, which is very fun and empowering with the move controllers. And I've also noticed as I've been playing through it that whenever I get a character in my face or I'm talking to a character, I sort of just naturally talk back. I've really gotten into the space, and it takes me a second. I talk to them, and then I realize, oh, wait a minute, I can't actually communicate with them that way. So it's kind of a neat sort of reality-bending experience. It's also the only game that I'm aware of, and I've tried out several, and I've been looking into picking up others as well, VR games that provide a very different experience. But in terms of open world, large, meaty games, Skyrim is kind of on its own island. Unfortunately, the graphics are outdated in part because the PS4 just can't handle some of the higher graphics levels anyway, but also Skyrim's an old game. So I don't really want to hold it against it.
Well, there's also the fact that the VR, you're basically projecting two 720 things.
Right, precisely.
And so you're having to render twice, and so they've got to compromise
and
a little bit.
And the PS4 just doesn't have the power to necessarily do that. But at the same time, I found it interesting that it took me about maybe, and each time I play, it takes me about 20 minutes to get into the game. And then once I, maybe a little less than that, maybe 10. But once I'm into it, that sort of shock at how bad the graphics are kind of goes away, because it's like I'm now in this world in which this is the way things look, and I just kind of look past it. I've actually never had that experience playing on a flat screen. I've never really had that, oh, this is just how the game is sort of feeling. I'm even if I like the lower fidelity graphics because of the style, stylistic or whatever, I'm always aware of them. But with Skyrim, because of the virtual reality element,
the
of
immersion,
it,
yeah,
right, I feel more like I'm in that world, and so
just like Lawnmower Man.
Yes, exactly. Like
no
Lawnmower
one's going to get that.
No, don't watch Lawnmower Man. Just don't subject yourself to that. But
well, if you do, watch the Riff Trax version.
Yes, yeah, that I would recommend. But yeah, so it's a very different experience from walking around inside the world and going to a town or going through a forest and going into a dungeon. It's almost like a dungeon is a different game in a way. It's a very different feel, different experience. And when I was in that first dungeon, I had this moment where, you know how you have you find that like dragon claw on the thief?
Mm-hmm.
So I open up the dragon claw in my inventory because I couldn't remember. I was trying to unlock the door. I couldn't remember what those symbols were. And I was getting really frustrated because I didn't know how to rotate the dragon claw with my move controllers. And I'm just like, I don't know how to do this. I can't see it. I can almost see the little shapes on there. And then I go, I wonder if I just kind of lean forward. And so I leaned forward and then ducked down. And I was like, wait a minute, I can actually do this. Mm-hmm. And I leaned forward, I ducked down, I looked up, and I realized, oh, I can move around in this space. It didn't hit me initially when I was playing. I was just standing still and teleporting forward and then standing in place and swinging or casting spells. I didn't realize I could actually step forward. I could step back. I could duck under things. I could move out of the way or move into something or lean forward. I had heard that PSVR had 6 degrees of freedom, but I didn't realize what that meant per se, or at least I didn't understand it properly. And that was kind of my like aha moment with the system because it solved the problem, and it solved it in a way that was natural. That was my natural inclination.
I gotta
admit,
I'm gonna lean forward. You're making me want to try it.
It's definitely worth trying. I think that you would
would sink, as many hours as I have into Skyrim.
I'll just go over to Chris's. Actually, I think I still have a key to your apartment, Jim.
There you go.
From whenever I cat sat.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Cat sat.
It's very an interesting experience. I think for me, the VR games that stand out the most are, the more I want to say like Tron inspired, like the like weird graphics or things like Rez or like Polybius or games like that, Thumper. To me, I've had really great experiences playing those games, and but they're very short, confined experiences, whereas Skyrim kind of demonstrates what can be done with VR in terms of like a very large open world game. And as
it
I'm
makes
getting,
a lot of sense, actually,
it really is cool. And the concept is great. If only it was a more alive world. And I don't just mean visually. I mean, Skyrim itself is not as alive as some open world games. So I think we could get to that point eventually. And it sort of, to me, it's almost like showing the potential of what you can do in VR.
Frame it this way. They didn't have to worry about the story or, the flow or the dev or any of that stuff. They had four other iterations to have balanced all that out.
Sure.
So in this case, they basically were really focusing hard on the VR experience.
Yeah.
And therefore, it has polish.
Right.
To your point, though, Jim, about the live world idea, there is a fan-made open source sort of engine rebuild of Morrowind called OpenMW.
Yes.
That's basically trying to bring Morrowind into a more modern engine, and so that it's got more support for modding and stuff. I wouldn't be shocked if in a few years, or maybe even longer, but eventually, that there is a VR fan-made VR version of Morrowind that you could play.
I would love to see some fan-made VR games, just large games like this that are any sort of a large open world game. If you could do that, which I know we can, it's just a matter of investment, right? If the market is there, if there's enough people willing to buy it, I think it could be very interesting and lead to a really immersive experience. I mean, isn't that why people play these open world games anyways, to kind of have all this freedom in this space to experience a different space, whether you're playing as yourself or like a particular defined character with a narrative, like say in Witcher. Either way, you're in this world and you're interacting with it, and you're interacting with the people in this world and the creatures in this world and etc. So to do that in VR just makes it all the more immersive. I mean, just imagine like a Grand Theft Auto in VR. I mean, that'd be pretty awesome.
Yeah, it really would. Yeah.
And like, you can even challenge yourself in new ways that you couldn't necessarily in original Skyrim.
Yes.
Like,
yes.
If you want to, it's really difficult, but you can actually do archery with like, you know, two hand, pull your arrow back and shoot it. And you actually have to be able to aim. And that's something that's really challenging and makes it a very different experience than playing it the way you would with just a controller.
Yeah. And for now, I'm intentionally playing at a low difficulty because I'm still kind of getting used to, like, I'll still do something in battle that I'm doing because I'm still learning. Even though I shouldn't be, I'm still learning the controls because it's natural, but it's not. Like, because I know I'm playing a game, but I'm also controlling the game in a way that's supposed to be more intuitive. And it kind of is, but I've played games for so long that to me, playing games with a controller is intuitive. So this is almost like I'm trying to unlearn certain skills that I've learned over years, many years, especially since I've played Skyrim the conventional way already.
I think what you just said is exactly the reason why I have not enjoyed VR, is because I'm like too old to be learning a new control scheme.
But I don't think that's true. I think that even if you were like 70 years old, you could still, instead of 69, you could still learn all these new skills.
Well, it depends on how truly body kinesthetic you're talking about here. I mean, if this really comes down to my twitch time on my thumb versus my twitch time in my entire core muscle body, you know, chest, trunk versus, I mean, my thumb's going to win every time.
Sure, but the sort of games that you're playing in this space are not really twitch, and Skyrim's not a twitch game anyway. I got news for you, if you've tried to play, because I have, modern FPS games, our Twitch is already gone. I mean, that's the
sadly, you're right.
The people that are the experts at this game, I mean, when they're experts, they're like 16, 18. If you're like 22 in that space, you're old.
Yeah, like the Overwatch League, for example, has some players who are in their late 20s, but they're considered the old guys.
They are. No, and those people, I'm sure they've already lost some of their Twitch, and they're probably using...
They're playing like support, tank,
yes,
that
they have
thing.
Like certain strategies they can employ that don't require as much Twitch. And I'm very aware of that because I used to play FPSs all the time. I was really into it when I was younger, and as I got older...
Yeah, back when they were fast.
Well, I just didn't have the reflexes, right? No, I mean, I know there's some differences now in terms of the way FPSs play, but still, going back to some of those old games, you can still find people to play.
Overwatch is slow.
I don't even like Overwatch. We're getting way off topic. Delete all this.
This is the topic.
Yeah. But PS, I would say the PSVR in general is worth at least experiencing. I'm sure I'll talk more about some other games in particular. Resident Evil 7 is worth, I think, its own segment. But Skyrim VR, to me, it is definitely worth trying, worth playing. And try it with the Move controllers if you first try it with the normal DualShock and it makes you sick, because it's going to happen when you first play VR. For a lot of people, they get sick when they first try it. You get used to it eventually, but the Move controllers allow you to interact in a way that will not make you sick. And I think that's important.
It's a lot better than it used to be, that's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. And it is intuitive. I mean, it is. I just, even for things like using a sword and shield, like blocking and swinging, it's just that you can do things like, I like to call it fling paw, where I just kind of like fling my hand around like a spastic.
Like a maraca.
Yeah, like I'm just a spastic person, because that you swing your weapon as fast as the controllers move. So that's your twitch right there, Doc. You know, you just do that, like you fling your hand
literally
around.
Literally looks like you're twitching.
And you hit somebody like 100 times in a second and they die instantly. Yeah. Nick, you've played Skyrim
as
well.
I played a little bit of Skyrim VR, and to your point, I think Skyrim VR just made me more excited for a dedicated VR open world RPG.
But it's definitely a lot of fun, and I actually had a really good time playing it, and I'm going to keep playing, going back and forth to it, because it almost feels like when I play it, it's like I'm stepping back into that world, as opposed to I'm going to play some Skyrim. It's more like I'm stepping into this world of Skyrim,
right,
and going and experiencing something.
And I think that the next big game that we're going to see that tries to do like a big open world RPG thing is probably going to be in like a either modern or a sort of sci-fi sort of setting. Because I found that generally speaking, VR works a lot better with like shooters than it does with melee. So again, like with the magic and Skyrim VR.
What about Link's crossbow training?
I think that's only for now, though. I think that, we're going to get, because even with the melee, if you try to play it straight, the melee actually works pretty well in Skyrim. You can take your hand and you can look at angles of weapons that you normally can't see in the normal game, because you can hold it in all these weird configurations and check it out. And if you want to, you can swing like a normal person and it's going to react that way. It's just that if you can exploit something, people will exploit it. And because you don't have force feedback when you strike something, it's still not, it's not going to feel as satisfying, right? So that's part of it that we're missing, but that doesn't mean that we can't get to that level. That doesn't mean we're not going to get to that level, though, right? So it's just a matter of getting to that point. But you're absolutely right. Currently, it's much more satisfying to shoot things. That's why I prefer playing a mage, because I can actually fire, you know, lightning bolts from my fingertips, which is fun.
It's time for War Stories, tales of tribulation and triumph in gaming.
So if you haven't heard about Dying Light ever, then you're like me. About 3 weeks ago, and then E3 happened, and there was an announcement that Dying Light 2 was coming out, and I was kind of like, what's that? I don't know. As it had happened, I took my cat to the vet, and the veterinarian's assistant there said that her son was playing a parkour zombie game, and I was going, I have no idea what that is. I know games. I'm on a video game podcast. It doesn't exist. Okay, so I was wrong, and it's Dying Light. The funny thing about it is it's done in first person, and this is what you've been reminding me of, Jim, while you were talking about the VR. Now, to my knowledge, there is no VR port of Dying Light, but I would not be surprised at all if for the second one, there ended up being a VR version of it, because it seems like it would fit absolutely perfectly. Now, the thing that sets it apart control-wise and a little bit differently than, say, Bioshock, or just pick your sort of unconventional, unusual first-person shooter, right, is that you have to aim the camera where you want to grab with your hands. Think about that for a second. So you jump, and if you don't aim the reticule at the place where you want to actually grab, you will probably fall off the ledge three stories up and die while trying to get away from zombies on a little island, which is basically in Turkey. Let's just throw that out there. It's a little Middle Eastern country that's fictional, right? So here's my war story about this, though. I actually happened upon it in one of those resale shops, you know, the kind that sells the books for half price, so to speak. And it's one of those...
half price books.
Yeah, there you go.
Chris.
Never heard of it.
We're not getting paid.
Yeah. You can send your checks. But what happened was I saw it in the big rack, you know, how they have the rack of games. And I was like, oh, you know, it's $20. It might be worth the risk. And I thought, yeah, I'm going to hold off. I'm going to do a little bit of research. Because this was the moment where I literally discovered the game on the shelf, which just, that's such a rare occurrence that I thought, you know, it's almost worth doing. Maybe it's rare. Pulled out the phone, because we have computers in our pants, and went, hey, this is kind of a deep rabbit hole. There's a lot of DLC. There's a lot of other stuff. I'm going to check and see how much it costs on, like, PlayStation to download it and all these other things. And what I discovered was this. The game is a couple of years old, but then they came out with a huge, massive DLC patch that was, as far as I can tell, actually put on a disc itself. And it was called The Following. And The Following then took your zombie hunting to the new level with basically a vehicle and apparently a story. There wasn't one before that. I don't know. And then after that, a bunch of other sort of freebies and new skins and new outfits and all this other mechanics got added in. And it feels like the game just sort of unveiled itself, unraveled itself slowly over the next couple of years, about 3 years worth of content. And then fairly recently, they came out with the version that was called the like the updated edition or the remastered edition, or, you know, it was the complete edition. And so they named it badly, in my opinion, because it's called Dying Light, The Following, and then Complete Edition.
And Knuckles.
Yeah, and Knuckles. And so it's very confusing because, like, I actually went to a certain place where you can stop and get games.
GameStop.
Yeah, there you go. And... You're welcome. Slam dunk. And went in there and I was like, listen, you're going to have to sort this thing out for me because I'm confused. I literally don't know if I'm buying the game. If I buy this thing, it's only $20. And that's the funny thing is it was $20 at the resale shop, but then it was $20 for a brand new copy of the absolutely everything unlimited super edition with all the DLC and everything else. And I got to say, it was not a code. It was actually on the disc. Now there were updates and stuff, but like the content itself was on the disc. I was super, super thrilled about this. So I've really been enjoying playing this game. The writing is terrible. The story is pointless, but the mechanics are deeply fun. It's parkour zombie killing, and it is completely open world, and it would be perfect for a VR. But it was completely worth the $20 is all I got to say. It was sort of that visceral thing that I was craving, and it's exactly what I got. I don't know. Check it out. Go watch some gameplay. See if it's something you'd be interested in. It made me a little bit dizzy at first because it is first person. But other than that, it's just been a really fun way to crunch zombie heads with cool content and driving cars and all these other things. So
this is the Gaming Meta. News and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
Have you heard about the scandal, guys? The Westworld versus Fallout Shelter scandal?
Oh, I thought you were talking about something in Washington again.
No, not that scandal. The big one.
Oh.
The one, this is the bigger one.
Yeah, the one about Behavior Games, which is the name of the dev that created the fairly well-received Fallout Shelter. Now, I think whenever I reviewed Fallout Shelter, I called it basically a tower builder. Which is what it really is. It's just not in a tower, you know, and the tower builder is it's a click and then get the timer going and then come back later and everything builds up and then you can earn more stuff.
And you have to fortify everything too, because you're going to be attacked. And you have to be prepared. And
You increase
it reminded me of Sim Tower, except you go down instead of up.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually that's
Sim Ant.
Perfect. So
no,
well, here's,
it's nothing like Sim Ant.
Here's the scandal, guys.
Except for your underground.
Yeah, okay.
Wow. Here's the scandal. The dev that made this behavior, they created a very nice little suite of software in order to be able to do this for Bethesda, right? Now, Westworld Season 2 has come out, and there have been some interesting plot developments in the show. Setting those aside, they made a little simulation game, which is basically you have people show up, they're guests, and they're entertained by hosts who are these android robot things, flesh popsicles. And what you have to do is you have to manage a delicate balance between what's going on underneath the park in the Disney tunnels and the things that are happening above the park in the... debauchery center.
Yes.
So what you're doing there is you're doing resource management, you're populating the different things, and you're trying to match hosts up with guests based on traits. And it's eerily similar to Fallout Shelter and trying to get people assigned to things. And it turns out that's because they both are developed by behavior.
Right.
And there's actually a lot of code that's been... I think copied is the allegation to the point where certain bugs exist in both. And now a lawsuit has come.
Yeah, that's what I was going to mention was, at least that I had read from it when I went to do a little bit of research on this topic.
You mean that link I sent you?
Yes, yeah. Exactly.
And the link I sent you.
Yeah, that.
No, I ignored that one.
Oh, okay.
I sent those straight to spam. No, but They essentially have first when the game came out, there were already some allegations that there may have been some copying because they are very similar on the surface. Yeah. Obviously, in terms of mechanics, there's a lot of similarities in terms of the way that it works. But and of course, it came from the same studio. So there's already that. Just how much is similar here? But there has been some specific bugs that they've found that when they've gone back and looked at the reasons behind those bugs, it's because of essentially the exact same problems in the code exists in both games.
Yeah, they used the same code. So they copied and pasted their code.
It's essentially the same game in a way, almost the same game, kind of reskinned with reusing a lot of the same code. And so it does open up that question once again of, you know, can you... Like, who owns the rights, essentially, to this game, the game mechanics, and not just the game mechanics. This goes beyond mechanics. This is actually the engine itself.
The engine itself,
and then also the code that runs that engine, that controls it, and that controls these two games. It's made by the same developer, so you would think, oh, there shouldn't be a controversy because it's maybe the same company. Well, the problem is, it might be developed by the same company, but...
But the
it's
publisher,
produced,
Bethesda.
The publishers are two separate companies.
Right. And that's Warner Brothers, by the way.
Yes. Yeah. And so now this is a problem because now there's the allegation of, and that's where the lawsuit comes in, hey, you can't do this. You just, you know, and I believe, are they suing Bethesda specifically or is it?
Bethesda is suing...
it's Bethesda that's suing.
Behavior.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
For having given away their intellectual property in the form of the code.
It was
which
a breach
was
of contract
on...
because they created the engine and the game and everything for Bethesda.
Yep.
And then when they went and did the same thing for Warner Brothers,
so,
that was
I gotta say, if in fact their contract is worded that way, they have a case and I think they deserve to win it. If, however, this is simply a case of not understanding the fundamental nature of the job of a developer and going, whoa, wait a minute. You used the same keyboard. You used the same computer. You used the same operating system. You used the same game engine. No, those are mine because you use them for me. That's like saying to the guy across the street who's painting your neighbor's house, hey, come over to my house and paint my house next. And he's like, yeah, I've got a bunch of extra paint from this job. I'll cut you a deal. And he comes over and he does that. And then your neighbor comes over and he's like, wait a minute, that's the same color paint. This is on my house. And I go, yeah. And in fact, he cut me a deal. He's like, I'm suing the painter. It's not a perfect metaphor.
I'm not sure what the connection is, to be honest.
No. I actually get the...
Did you get it?
No, I think you made a good point there. And I think there is a strong connection there because... it depends on what you're paying for.
Correct.
Right?
That's exactly my point.
So if you're paying for all the materials for this person to come and paint your house, and that's part of what you're paying them.
The ladder,
and they
the
have some and,
tray pans.
Right.
The, yeah.
And they have some
that's
of those.
A technical term, tray pans.
Sure.
Right.
And they have some of those materials left over. Technically, those materials belong to you because you paid for them. And then they use those materials to do another job. Well, guess what? They kind of did breach. They were in breach of the contract that you had with them. Now, the question is.
They sold it twice, in other words.
In a sense, yes. Yeah. Now, it does go into. Exactly. It does go into who does it really belong to. A lot of that comes down to contract. In this case, we're talking about the game itself. And
so in your metaphor, Doc, basically what the first guy paid for the guy to paint the house, and he also paid for three buckets of paint.
Right.
Yeah.
So when
the supplies,
like 30,
too.
But yeah.
Yeah, yeah, the supplies too. Like the paint brushes, the trays.
Yeah, because those wear out.
Let's say he even gave him all the paints, right?
Right.
Even if he's using the paint brushes and the trays, the same trays and paintbrushes, because you're not just going to throw those out. And the person that you sold to, you're not going to expect them to want them. It's like, hey, I painted your house. Do you want this tray and these paintbrushes that I used? That seems like a weird thing to say, right? But if you use it on a later job in a way, because you use the money from the previous job to buy them, you're kind of using resources and that don't really belong to you in a sense. Now, it depends on how you think about it. And
of course, that wasn't in writing because it's a paint job for a house.
Right.
Unless
but,
it was.
Hey, but it could have been.
Yeah, in the metaphor, no.
Right.
Yeah.
But it could have been in writing. Depends on, you know, if it's a big job, those
Judge
are
Judy.
In writing. And in
She'll
this case,
sort it out.
There we go. And in this case, all of this was in writing. So the question then becomes, exactly what does the contract say? And part of the issue, too, I think, is that they've built this engine and they want to get more bang for their buck, right? They don't just want to just build something completely from scratch to do essentially a very similar game. That's silly. But even if they did, they would still probably copy code. Why?
And they still charge them the full rate.
It's more efficient. But it's more efficient to copy code over. if it's going to do the same thing. If you know something's going to work, why wouldn't you do that?
Yep.
Right. So
what scares me about this is not that Bethesda might lose some money or that, Warner Brothers might lose some money, or you know what I'm saying? Doesn't scare me. This will get worked out in the industry. What scares me is a precedent by a judge who does not understand the nature of a game mechanic and might accidentally set a precedent for being able to copyright game mechanics.
Now, what do you mean? Judge Judy knows what she's talking about.
She does. That's very true. This is not going to Judge Judy. Yeah,
unfortunately, Judge will not go to Judge Judy. I would trust Judge Judy to handle this.
Yeah, Wapner's retired and or dead, so that won't work.
And that's kind of the trick too, though, is because it's not necessarily the game mechanics, it's more the code itself. And
well,
so
another intellectual property behind the idea. Yeah, where do we draw that line?
Another imperfect metaphor is, maybe let's talk academia.
Yeah.
When you're writing a paper, it actually is, if I understand correctly, possible to plagiarize yourself.
That's true.
And so you could argue this is maybe something a little bit along those lines, where there are certain things that you are not supposed to plagiarize yourself on.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe just somewhere in the
code,
somewhere in the legal agreement.
If you cite yourself, though, and that's the point.
Yeah.
I think that,
and that's the thing, is like, because they did also create the original code, but then it does come down to, like we were saying, the contract of who owns what parts of the code and that
right.
sort of thing.
So I'm really wondering if, and we may never know, but if it comes out that Behavior says, listen, we were fully intending on doing this. It was completely understood that we'd made this for this other company. We cut them a deal because our time was halved. And we just really didn't think about the fact that there was a claim by Bethesda that they might own this part of this thing because it's not in writing. That's a completely different argument than if it comes out where it's like, so we paid them to develop a thing that we had already developed, or rather we charged them to develop a thing that we had already developed, and it was very, very obviously a cash grab for us to get our people and charge them for, let's say, 100 hours of work that didn't happen, or 1,000 hours, or whatever it ends up being.
Yeah,
that's a completely different argument. And if that is the case, and I know software developers who do that sort of thing all the time. They charge the full price for a thing they've already developed. That's dirty. And that's I think a problem in the industry, not necessarily the games industry, but the software industry. And the way that licensing works on software anyway, like the OS on your computer at home, you don't own that. You're licensing that. And they can just withdraw the license at any point, at which point you have a computer hardware thing that doesn't work anymore. And then Microsoft goes out of business and that doesn't happen. So this will never happen.
Thankfully, I have 3.1, so I don't think they're
perfectly.
Gonna,
yeah. It's a philosophical argument.
Linux.
But I think that there's something that needs to be, groundwork that needs to be laid here. If we have 1,000 little cases like this, we need to take note of them and why it matters and what it is that's really happening here. This is a case of they stole money from a company because they had already made it, then shame on you, Behavior. But if this is a case where somebody like Bethesda going, wait, no, you can't make games for them because you made that for us, then shame on you, Bethesda. You see what I'm saying? And either way, I wonder whether or not Warner Brothers really was complicit in any of it. And they're like, oh, great.
Yeah.
What did
we do?
So
here, I think that the solution, or at least the ruling, is going to probably be somewhere in the middle, because there was probably a combination of a lot of that, both sides kind of going on. And some of that stuff, I feel, and I may be giving the developers more credit than they deserve. I don't know. I don't know anyone that works there, and I don't know really this developer studio at all. But I will say I do understand some about the industry and people that work in it.
Mm-hmm.
And I do think that this could very easily be a case where there was no malicious intent, but they were just trying to save some time in terms of developing, and trying to basically, you know, they're looking at what they've built. They're looking at the code and they're like, I need this to work like this. How do I do it? Oh, I'll just copy some of this code over. You know, it's like, it's a
highly likely scenario.
It makes sense, because you're thinking, I'm trying to save time. I'm trying to figure out this problem, because a lot of programming is figuring out problems. Like, I have this problem. I got to make thing X do thing Y. How do I do that? I'm going to go look at what someone else did over here that's kind of similar, look at their code and see what can I use, not literally the code, but what can I use or glean from that to figure out for my thing. In this case, they literally had the exact code to do the exact thing they want. And they go, well, that's easy. I'll just literally copy and paste this code, because you do that in programming. Yep. So now, maybe they shouldn't have done that, but I think for a lot of these programmers, it doesn't even cross their mind, because they're like, oh, we have access to the code. this is like within our company, why shouldn't we be allowed to do it? Yep. So I think it could very easily be a situation where they had people that were working at a low level that they were not told to do this. There was no one in the company that said, we want you to do this. They just weren't told that they can't do it, or they didn't they didn't read the contract. If you're working on this project, you're not going to go, okay, everybody read this contract real quick. Read this, like, 20-page contract. No, they're given a job, they're given a task, and they do it in what they feel is the most efficient way possible.
Yep. Well, clearly the moral, the takeaway, the end of the day thing here is that art imitates life, because this is exactly what happened to the robots on Westworld and the reason why the park fell apart and started killing humans. It's because they were careless with their code. Just saying. It's a morality tale.
Yeah. And that's also the plot behind every Jurassic Park film.
Well, Michael Crichton was the brainchild of the original Westworld, so you're not far off. In fact, he sort of ripped off his own idea there, too.
This is the Mobile Minute, where we share something new or noteworthy about those computers we keep in our pants.
So, recently I've played Framed, which is a new mobile game.
Oh, that's the Roger Rabbit game, right?
Actually, no, but it is a noir sort of detective-ish game. You play as a detective type character stylistically,
really?
But you're not really solving crimes. What you're doing is there are frames on the screen, kind of like comic book panels.
Oh, no way.
Yes, and you have to move the frames to make the story work. Essentially, you're trying to escape from people that are after you, or trying to infiltrate a building or a particular area, or escape from a particular area after you've infiltrated it, and you're getting caught by security, or you're getting shot or shot at or something.
That is
and
amazing.
The only way you can get through on each quote unquote page is to rearrange the panels so that you can escape, right? Or you can come up behind the people that are after you and hit them over the back of the head and knock them out. It has a really neat soundtrack, too. So what I've noticed is when playing through the game is that it starts out and does a really good job of teaching you how to play it by incrementally making it more and more difficult to or learning more and more skills that allow you to make sure that your character survives. Not just in terms of rearranging the panels, but as you move forward, you could do things like rotate the panels. And when you rotate the panels, it can actually, at first, you're just rotating it in place. But later on, when you have panels of different sizes, like some that are longer or shorter or what have you, when you rotate it, it changes the possible configurations of the panels on screen, which opens up a whole new level of complexity. It is a pretty fun game. It's actually really cheap, only available for, I believe, about $3. Comes from Love Shack. And I really recommend checking it out. And don't play it on mute, because the soundtrack is really neat.
Believe it or not, we're not always playing games. Every now and then, we like to talk about the other stuff.
All right, so we talked about the Westworld mobile game, which I do recommend, by the way. I think it's better than Fallout Shelter was. But it is so completely falling short of what Westworld has become, especially now that season 2 has finished up. They go into the mechanics of what the androids are, or I should say the hosts are, a little bit deeper in season 2. We now know that they have sort of a brain ball that's in their head, and it's bulletproof, and there's a little casing, and to get into that, there's special hardware that's on the premises in the park, and that it also goes into a little bit of how the original ones had frames that were made of metal, and then later, as seen in the movie, back in the 70s. And then later on, the technology evolved, about 6 different iterations of that, until we see them 3D printing them in the opening and all of that that's come around, where they're basically little walking flesh bags, and they're very easy to repair when they get shot. And they're almost like sort of slug-like in their consistency, but they're a little more dense in certain places. And that's how they get that very, very human quality about them. So it was kind of interesting for me then, because I started playing Detroit Become Human, and I talked a little bit about Detroit in a different episode, but one of the things that really struck me is how much of a dialogue between the two completely seemingly unrelated pieces are actually there about this notion of AI and androids and looking human and becoming human, and what does that really mean? And there's a line in Westworld that talks about people having code that is only like 1,500 lines or something, and it's a joke. And the idea behind it is that in order to simulate a human, it's actually a very simple process. You just have to figure out what their particular hangups are and at what frequency, and then you're good. You can simulate an individual at that point. And that kind of got me to thinking in the context of Detroit Become Human, whether or not that was explored sufficiently enough with like the Kamsky test and that kind of a thing. So we're going to do a round table on Detroit Become Human. So I don't want to go too deep into that right now, but I do find interesting that little dialogue between the sort of the fleshy meat puppet idea of an android. And we've moved away from sort of a Star Wars metal body idea and over into something that's a little bit closer to Blade Runner. As it was originally described in the book, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? And, you know, the sequel, of course, came out to Blade Runner recently.
Mm-hmm. And we see that in the film, too.
It's in the film. Yeah, the fleshiness. Totally. But it's not really, the technology behind it is not really explained. And we live in this really interesting sort of moment, I would say, artistically within the context of Android story, where, you know, 30, 40 years ago, we didn't really care about it looking, feeling, seeming human. But today, it's almost like there's this visceral element to the copying, where if we can look at them and immediately tell they're not a human, then they're not a human, and we don't buy it. And yet, in Star Wars, for example, we could say that the droids are the most human characters of all, like 3PO right. and R2-D2, and their interaction is the most.
Look at Data from Next Generation,
yes.
who clearly, you know, he could take off his parts. You could see he was 100%.
He had white skin,
100% android, and yet was a very human character on the show. And they even had a whole episode dedicated to, you know, is he human? Does he have does he have freedom to choose?
Right.
And it was actually one of the most brilliant episodes on the in the series, yeah. which is saying
and
quite
it's like,
a bit.
Data, you want to be human. That's a desire. That's you're already human.
Right.
Moving on.
Right.
You know, and so that I think was really interesting. So just as a quick side note, because I was playing Detroit and the things that were going on with the mechanics of Detroit, I really was wondering if it suffered just a little bit from the mechanics as opposed to something that's handed to you like Westworld for that theme of the androids. And I think one great way to contrast that, maybe get a third point of perspective, is to look at a game like Until Dawn, which I finished, and managed to successfully get everybody out of the house without dying.
That's such a fun game.
Yeah, and I read this brilliant article, and it said that Until Dawn solves all the problems that have ever been with the B-movie horror genre because you can make it so that everyone survives. And it has a bit of an identity crisis, too. There's a humorous element to it, but it's also very scary, where you think at the beginning it's about a psycho killer, and then you realize that it's actually a little deeper than that, and then you realize it's a little deeper than that,
yeah.
and then you finally, towards the last chapters, realize what the real true threat is, and it turns into a moment where you're almost like, is this a supernatural thing, or is it explainable by science or not?
That's surprisingly nuanced, right?
Yeah, and that's my common thread to all of this that I've been saying in this segment, which is this idea that in order for us to have that modern notion to hook us, we have to have it's almost like a Newtonian hook that allows us to go, okay, I can anchor this into a reality that's a possible future. So instead of just being willing to embrace the sci-fi or the horror sci-fi, we actually have to have a little bit of, let's call it hard sci-fi as a seed or a nugget to grow everything out of. And that's the trend I'm noticing right now, is that Westworld, as it was done in the movie in the 70s, would not fly right now. And the reason why is because it's not visceral enough, to use exactly the right word. And I think that that's worth taking note of as a modern artistic trend that's happening right now in our games, in our movies, and in our series, is that we're really not allowing just an openness in imagination to thrive. We're still keeping our imagination in a box. And there's this dialogue that is happening between these seemingly unrelated pieces that, if you look deep enough, I think that there's something meaningful there. Anyway, I'm going to set that aside. Maybe more on it later.
It's time for Game Show, where the Backward Compatible crew play a game show kind of game on their gaming show. What sort of crazy game show challenges in store this week on Game Show? Let's find out right now on Game Show.
It's E3 once again, and it's time to play a game of Buy, Try, Trash. And as y'all might remember, the way that we play Buy, Try, Trash is that I'm going to give y'all three different games. And in this case, they're all going to be games that were announced at E3. So none of us have played these games yet. We don't know how good they're going to be, but we're going to speculate. And we're going to pick, you're going to pick whether you want to, which game you want to buy, which means you own the game, you can play it as much as you want, which game you want to try. Which is essentially you get to play, you get to demo the game. You get to play it for, you know, maybe half an hour. You get to see what it's like. You get to experience a little bit, a little nugget of the game. But that's it. And then trash, of course, means not only can you, will you not own this game? Not only will you not play this game doesn't even come out. It doesn't exist anymore. It's canceled. Game is canceled. It's gone.
Okay, so who goes first?
I'm going to address Chris first, I think.
All right.
There are several games that were announced at E3. So I'm going to pick three games that I think you're interested in. Mm-hmm. Hopefully I will be right. If not, that's fine too. One of the most important parts of this game is not just that you tell me which games you want to buy, try, trash, but you give us a reason so that we can kind of understand your headspace. Mm-hmm. And it's not going to be the same for everybody, and that's perfectly fine. But this gives us a little bit of insight into you, what kind of gamer you are, what mm-hmm. kind of games you like. And just kind of your initial impressions of some of these games, right?
Cool.
Here are the three games. Fire Emblem Three Heroes, Cyberpunk 2077, Elder Scrolls 6.
Hmm. Okay. Gotcha.
I wanted to go for very different games. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to just do all Nintendo or anything. I know you're a Nintendo fan, but I didn't want to. I thought it'd be more fun to do some different experiences.
Gotcha. That's tricky, because I was very excited when I saw the Fire Emblem announcement. It's been a while since we had a console Fire Emblem, and
it really has been. Radiant Dawn, right?
Yeah, Dawn back on the Wii.
Yeah.
But the first one, at least that we got in the US, because the series started off on, like, you know, NES and SNES.
Yes.
But it was a very long time before we eventually got Path of Radiance on the GameCube.
Actually, the first game that we got in the US was on the Game Boy Advance, yep. And it was just called Fire Emblem.
Yep. Yeah. And that was technically Fire Emblem 7, if you're following the Japanese series.
Yes, I think that's right.
And so when Path of Radiance came out, it actually broke a lot of new ground for the series, at least as far as I'd experienced it. They added a lot of features that ended up becoming mainstays of the series moving mm-hmm. forward.
Still one of my favorites.
Mm-hmm. Plus, it just kind of like it was cool to see everything kind of animated in 3D, and it did some really neat stuff. Like it seems like the console ones experiment a lot more than some of the some of the handhelds do.
Yeah, I think so. That being said,
Awakening started like this whole new trend of like doing something pretty radically different with it. And then Cyberpunk 2077, I'm a big fan of CD Projekt Red on paper. I've not played through The Witcher 3. What I've heard of it and what I've played of it, I've appreciated. I just haven't gotten around to playing it all. So I'm definitely interested in it. And what was kind of cool is the trailer to me suggested it was kind of like bringing the punk back into cyberpunk,
yes.
If that makes
yes.
sense.
And it's based off of an old tabletop game, too. I don't know if you're aware of this stock in yeah. particular, but it is.
I'm familiar with the old tabletop game. That's actually
neat.
My lead in to be interested again. Mm-hmm. Because when I heard the announcement, I was kind of like, they'll break it. It'll be horrible. Because the comparisons were being made to, to The Witcher. And that's just not right.
But it's presented in a different way.
Yes. And once I found out a little bit more about that, I became interested again. Yeah.
And so one of the things that really intrigues me is how it has this sort of synthwave aesthetic that cyberpunk in theory has, but none of the stuff that I've actually consumed in cyberpunk has that aesthetic. It's always more of like a Blade Runner-esque sort of thing. So I'm intrigued by this direction of kind of like having this more colorful presentation, I guess you can say.
Yes.
And then with Elder Scrolls 6, obviously we don't know much, but I appreciate Elder Scrolls on a lot of levels, but I'm not the biggest fan.
Need to play Morrowind. I will never stop evangelizing for Morrowind.
But so between those three, probably the one I'm least interested in is going to be Elder Scrolls 6. So I'm going to go and call that one my trash.
In this case, you are trashing it specifically for Nick too.
Mm-hmm.
There's an extra extra addendum here for your version.
I'm canceling the project. Okay. Elder Scrolls 6 has been canceled, guys.
Sorry, Nick.
And after all that effort to put together that 10-second teaser trailer,
yeah, we'll get into that later.
Yeah. The other two, it's tricky. I think Cyberpunk. I'm sure it's going to be very promising. I'm sure it's going to have a lot of great depth to it and a lot of good stuff to play, but I feel like I could probably get away with just trying it in the same way that The Witcher is kind of something that I could try and appreciate but not have gotten through. And maybe someday I'll still get around to finishing it when I got time. It's a thing that I lack. And I'll go in and say that I would buy Fire Emblem because that's just one of my favorite series, and new console Fire Emblem is always super promising. So that's what I'm doing.
Good choices. Interesting. Wasn't as hard for you as I thought it might be, but there was some good commentary, I think, for some of those games.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Nick, you're up next. You're on the hot seat.
All right.
Buy, try, trash. Here are your three games. Elder Scrolls 6.
Okay.
You knew it was coming.
Yes.
Forgotten City.
Okay.
Smash Ultimate.
All right. So here's my reasoning. I already know the answer. So here's my reasoning. Smash Ultimate, I'm going to trash.
Whoa. Uh-oh.
Because Super Smash Bros.
Controversial.
Melee, we already have previous Smash games, which when it's a fighting game / sports game, you can kind of call it a sports game, and that it's like, it's not a story or whatever, so you're not like missing out on like a big piece of the story by getting rid of an installment.
It is an esport, so.
It's essentially the same game as the other Smash Bros, just better / different. So I'm fine just keeping Smash Bros up to what we have now. I'm fine with Melee. I'm fine with Smash 4. And eventually there will be another Smash game after this.
No. There's no more after this if you trash Ultimate. Okay. Ultimate is the ultimate Smash experience.
Well, fine.
Okay.
I'm still fine with Melee.
All right. So. Fair enough.
Forgotten City, I'll try because it looks cool, but it's not Elder Scrolls 6.
For those of us that don't, that may not know, listeners that may not know, do you want to tell us briefly what Forgotten City is?
Right. So Forgotten City is a game that was announced by the developer Modern Storyteller. It started out its life as a mod for Skyrim, actually. Basically, it is a sort of story expansion to Skyrim, fan-made, where you find yourself inside of a Dwemer ruin that has there's no way out. So anybody who has gone in there before you has to basically live in the town there. And there's this rule in the city called the Dwarves Law, where if anybody commits a sin, which means stealing or killing anybody or harming anybody, everybody in the town has to die. So
kind of harsh.
Yeah.
Little harsh. It's a little bit like Buy, Try, Trash. It's
yeah.
a very harsh but fair system.
Yes. Well, I don't know if it's fair, but yeah. Basically, that's the premise of the game. And you arrive, and the whole point is that you know that somebody is going to commit a sin and get everybody killed because you actually went back in time into the city after it had been destroyed and after everybody had been wiped out. So your objective is to talk to everybody in the town and do your best to prevent that person from sinning or whatever.
So after you give that description of the game, which I think is very interesting and makes me want to play it, I don't know what the audience is thinking. What are you doing with this game?
I'm trying it.
You're trying it. Okay.
Yeah, I'm trying it partially because, and this is a bit of a cop out, but the Skyrim mod is already still there and it's still very good. And Forgotten City actually is just, from what I can tell, it is just a kind of reimagining / remake of the Skyrim mod.
And I find it interesting that you're trying Forgotten City, even though it's this very large narrative experience that will take you a long time to play, and not trying Smash Ultimate when you could actually kind of get learn a lot about the game just playing half an hour. So do you have a reason behind that?
Because most of my interest in Forgotten City is how it is different from the original.
I see.
Because okay. I think the original still holds up. It actually won a National Writers Guild award for the writing and everything. It's a very, very solid mod / gameplay experience. And what's interesting about Forgotten City is that it's like set in like modern times, or like you're a modern explorer type going back in time into the city or whatever.
Neat.
So it's like it's a different take on the same story from what I can tell. And I'm interested mostly just to see what the differences are.
So I guess by process of elimination, you are buying Elder Scrolls 6.
Well, yes.
I can't say I'm surprised, but you want to give us a little reason as to why?
It's another installment in the Elder Scrolls series, even though it's, you know, It's a new Elder Scrolls game, which means it's probably going to be worse than Skyrim because Skyrim was worse than Oblivion and so on.
Oh, that's very cynical. Be positive.
You're forgetting about the online. Oh, never. No, you're not.
No, that doesn't exist.
I like
how
you called it another installment of Elder Scrolls and not the sixth installment, because it's not the sixth installment.
No.
It's just another installment.
Right.
Even though it's called Elder Scrolls
that's
6.
A much better name.
Well, it's actually, I think it's the 11th installment.
There's been several installments that have not been officially numbered.
Right. Yeah. There was the two adventure games, and then a few like mobile games that are
and online.
Yeah, online.
Yeah. So there's several. I mean, it's still part of the Elder Scrolls umbrella.
Yeah.
Do you know anything about Elder Scrolls 6?
I know as much as everybody else, which is to say, I saw the 10-second video. It's 26 seconds. I counted.
You would.
Well, then you do know more than
you
most
do
people.
Know.
And I joked about the effort, but like that was actually a pretty rich looking landscape. So
yeah,
I
mean, actually, what's interesting is that like if that's supposed to be in-engine footage or like an actual shot of the map, that's a pretty big map compared to most other Elder Scrolls games. Yeah. So they might be scaling up,
which would be interesting. Would be neat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then there's tons of fan speculation as to where that game is going to be set. My money's on High Rock, which is another Imperial province, but like we can't really. It's 26 seconds, guys. Like, chill out. Wait, cool. Wait a couple years.
So just to review, Nick is buying Elder Scrolls 6. He is trying Forgotten City, and he's trashing Smash Ultimate.
Correct.
Doc.
Yes.
You are up.
Okay.
I got three for you as well. So here we go.
I figured you did.
Assassin's Creed Odyssey.
Okay.
Ghost of Tsushima.
Okay.
And Dying Light 2.
Okay. So you've put me in an awkward position here.
Oh, good.
Yeah, because the nature of the game by Tri-Trash requires me to spend money on one of those.
No, you get the these games for free. These experiences
well
are free.
Then that's not buying, is it, Jim?
it's
that's
acquiring.
A five finger discount.
It's being bought for you,
and that's illegal.
You're buying into the game is
oh.
really what it's
oh yeah. Okay,
you're greenlighting
well
it.
Okay, so I'm actually kind of intrigued by this interesting turn that Odyssey represents, because it is obviously a reference to Odysseus, and it's very much engaging in mythology, which is something that, except for, let's call them, animus errors, that series, that franchise has never done this. Now, there's been fantastic elements before, but there's never been actual Minotaurs, you know? There's
right.
never been,
right.
You know, Polyphemus, the
Cyclops.
Cyclops, thank you. Yeah, all I was getting was John Goodman from... anyway,
nice.
Doesn't matter. The idea of it being no longer a genetic memory, but actually something out of myth, both really excites me and absolutely horrifies me, because I enjoyed Origins very, very much. I thought Origins was fantastic. One of the, if not the best, one of the best entries ever. And I'm terrified that they're going to just run this thing into the ground. And some people are laughing because they're like, they ran it into the ground years ago. What are you talking about? And that's fine. But so I will. Now, I haven't actually, this disclaimer, I haven't actually bought an Assassin's Creed game in years, like many, many, many iterations. I let my dad buy them. He's like 68 years old. And he loves to buy these things, and then I just borrow them and don't give them back for a really long time. And so I don't know if that gets me off the hook of actually buying it.
It doesn't.
So, okay. In order
You're not
to,
off the hook.
Okay. So, well, I think my try is going to end up being Ghost.
Really?
Yeah. Because, I think it is probably truer to the Assassin's Creed experience than than any of the recent Assassin's Creeds have been.
Yeah, that was my thought when I saw the trailer, that this looks like it's sort of in the spirit of Assassin's Creed, but a little bit more focused on the action-y elements,
yep.
Almost like a cross between that and maybe like a Dark Souls
but
or Neo. Or
here's the irony.
Yeah.
Okay. It is actually Japanese fantasy.
It
uses Japanese fantasy, and there are fantasy creatures in there, almost God of War like.
It also uses Japanese history specifically.
That's true too.
Yeah, it mixes the two,
and that totally works. You know, it's like Rising Sun, the board game. It completely works. So here's the thing.
It just works.
But the thing is, it doesn't have the history that Assassin's Creed has in order to do this. I would actually be much happier with Ubi if they would just say, listen, in the style of Assassin's Creed, we're starting a new franchise. We're branching into a new thing, mythology. You're going to love it. It's going to be great. And go. And then I would be all over it. I would be slobbering over it. And unfortunately, because they stuck Assassin's Creed on there, I'm like, guys, let it go. Let it just die or whatever. Or you know, be true to yourselves. Be true to what it is. Historical. I mean, so in that sense.
But maybe they want to try something new and know that Assassin's Creed mainline game will sell.
Yeah,
but that's the problem.
It's all about the name.
But that's the problem. And this gets to my point, my previous point about there needing to be sort of a seed of a Newtonian element to it.
Yeah.
And the fiction was Animus allows you to relive genetic memories. Go. And if that's no longer the fiction, if that is literally not the core of the conceit anymore, then they've broken the gameplay experience.
Well, and they've also broken the story of the first of the trilogy.
Of everything, frankly.
Have you considered that maybe they're not breaking that? Maybe it's supposed to happen, but they're just saying that these mythological events and creatures really happened.
And that could be, because there's always been that sort of alien element to it and this fantastic element to it. And I don't know yet. So because I don't know yet, I'm actually on board, more on board with Ghost of Tsunami to
Tsushima.
Yeah, that I don't like sushi. To play that. So I'm going to go ahead and buy that. I'm going to try Odyssey. And what was the third one?
Oh, geez. You talk so much. Oh, Dying Light 2.
Right. And I'm going to trash Dying Light 2.
Really?
Which is, yeah, maybe that's surprising.
That is surprising for me.
But the reason for that is I've had fun with Dying Light, but I am not majorly invested into Dying Light. And I also think that there's a fundamental genre shift in Dying Light 2 from Dying Light 1. One is there's this island that's infected with these zombie-like things. They hang this very quick lantern on it, and they're like, it's like rabies. And I'm like, oh, someone's seen 28 Days Later. Cool.
Yeah.
And then they just move on. And that's fine. That's completely appropriate for it. It looks to me like Dying Light 2 is trying way too hard to be a post-apocalyptic, post-zombie thing that has this really in-depth story, and paramilitary organizations are now out and everything. No, it's way cooler to be in a place that is literally falling apart, and you run across a random person who's been stuck on their roof for 3 days, and they're like, help me, save me, than it is to be, 4 years ago when the world became zombies, blah, 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 blah. I just don't care.
So even Chris Avellone's involvement with writing doesn't tempt you?
It tempts me. I'm intrigued. And I IRL outside of this this game.
Well, no, you're being held to this. This is
is this in my contract?
This is contractually binding.
Then I change everything. but yeah, that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna trash Dying Light 2, buy Ghost, and then try Assassin's Creed Odyssey. Yeah.
All right, Jim, you're not off the hook.
Yeah, totally.
I've got one for you.
Lay it on me.
Your games are Red Dead Redemption 2, Death Stranding, and Smash Ultimate.
Okay.
You should have gone with Call of Cthulhu.
Well, I'm not going to.
Okay. These are some good choices. So I'm a really big Rockstar fan, as I think everyone here knows.
Everywhere
a massive fan of Rockstar, and I love what they've produced. I've been looking forward to Red Dead Redemption 2 for a long time. I really enjoyed the first one. That being said, I'm also a really big Hideo Kojima fan, and Death Stranding has been a game that I've looked forward to just to kind of see what he comes up with. It's even with the trailer, it presents itself as, oh, there's not going to be a whole lot of as much stealth. You're Daryl the delivery guy or something, and there's going to be some action in it and maybe a little bit of stealth, and you're not really sure what this game is yet. But I have enough faith in Kojima to know that he can produce an engaging experience, even if it's an unconventional game. And that's kind of what he's been known for before he became the Metal Gear guy, was he's going to produce a game that surprises you and presents, you know, game mechanics and the way that the game is designed in a way that is unconventional and different. And I'm expecting him to go back to that with Death Stranding.
Within the Metal Gear series, he did that.
No, he did, but he became known as that Metal Gear guy for so long, and some people just didn't even try some of the Metal Gear games because they thought they knew what they were going to get, and they frankly didn't, but they thought they knew.
I resemble that remark.
Right. Some people may get into that space, and I get it because there's a lot of cutscenes, and he does a lot of this weird mixture, and sometimes it's a little bit too eclectic for people, and I understand that, but it's always engaged me. It's always interested me. And then of course, Smash Ultimate. That was an interesting pick because I've skipped the Wii U version of Smash, in part because I knew there was going to be a Switch version, and I sort of was done with the Wii U after a while, and I was sort of holding out for the Switch version. And Smash Ultimate, even though I've heard it referred to as an expansion or a remake of the Wii U version, which is really not.
We'll get into that later.
Yeah, we'll get into that too. It's really not. I think that's a false claim, frankly. But it is meant to be we're going to give you every character, every experience that you've had from any other Smash, and it really is meant to be the Smash Ultimate, and it's also meant to be Sakurai's last Smash game, and it's meant to be, in a way, the last Smash game. Now, will it be? Probably not. Eventually, Nintendo will come out with a new system, and they'll come out with a new Smash. I'm sure they will, regardless of whether Sakurai is involved or not. But at least for this first set of Smash games, going all the way back to the N64, this is meant to be the ultimate experience. And so that does intrigue me more than I thought a Smash game was going to intrigue me, even though Waluigi is not involved, and that does disappoint me.
It hasn't been announced yet.
We'll see. Hopefully he gets in there. So... tough choice, but I think, first of all, I'm going to have to, I think I'm going to have to trash Smash Ultimate.
See, now you get where I'm coming from.
it's a tough one, but the reason I'm trashing it is more because of the choices for the others, really. It was a tough choice for me, but I feel that I've played enough Smash that I know what I'm going to get, and I have to at least try Death Stranding. I want to know what the game is. Mm-hmm. And I'm just too curious to let that go away, to just never know what that game's about.
That's
right?
Similar to my Assassin's Creed argument, actually.
So I have to know what it is. And so because of that, I can't trash it. And I absolutely can't trash Red Dead Redemption 2. Thought crossed my mind. It really did. I'm not kidding. I actually weighed it. But at the same time, I've been looking so forward to that game, and I have a lot of faith in Rockstar, despite no story DLC for Grand Theft Auto 5. I'm still peeved about it, but at the same time, Grand Theft Auto 5 remains one of my favorite gaming experiences of all time, and I don't say that lightly. I love that game so much, even though there's no story DLC. I love it, despite all their focus on Grand Theft Auto Online. I'm going to have to go with buy on Red Dead Redemption 2. I am all in. I trust Rockstar until they prove me wrong. They have yet to do so. They have yet to disappoint me. Aside from not giving me more of what they've already given me for a game experience, when it comes to a new game, the most disappointed I've ever gotten was Grand Theft Auto 4, and I still really enjoyed that game and played the hell out of it, and that was the most disappointed I've ever been. So I have to buy it, which means I'm going to try Death Stranding. I think I can at least understand some about the game. I'll be disappointed not to play more, but it was a difficult choice. I feel there's at least going to be more hours of gameplay in Red Dead Redemption 2 as well. I expect that game to be a well over 100-hour experience for me, and that's saying a lot, and I think that I will still enjoy that time spent in that game. So for that reason, I'm all in. I'm buying it. Now, if it was Bully 2, I could trash both the others. I mean, that's how I'm all in. Rockstar, if you're listening, I know you are big fans of the show. Thank you. We love your support. Please make Bully 2. Please.
I agree with that, actually. I wholeheartedly agree with that.
I would swap Red Dead Redemption 2 for Bully 2. Unfortunately, that's not the choice. I stand by what I said before. I will buy Red Dead Redemption 2. I will trash Smash Ultimate, and I will try Death Stranding.
Well, go home this afternoon, Jim, and download that new DLC for Grand Theft Auto, the Stockholm DLC. It's completely free, and you're guaranteed to love them no matter how much they abuse you.
Secretly, Red Dead actually is the story DLC for GTA 5.
There we go.
Yeah,
there you go.
this week's meaty topic of discussion.
As part of our lead into E3, we also have an inbox segment. A letter came in that directly addresses one of the conferences in particular at E3. Gives us kind of a topic to sort of talk around and sort of lead us into more discussion. Chris, please go ahead.
So this letter comes from Esther. The subject line on the email was E3 hype and corporate HR.
Oh, I see where this is going. I like it already.
Hello, Backward Compatiblings. I was watching Bethesda's E3 coverage live, and despite having looked forward to it, found myself pretty annoyed at the whole thing.
Amen, sister.
There was just this overriding attitude of, you should be excited to buy products from us, spend, 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 that I got not only from Bethesda, but just the general atmosphere surrounding E3. But when Todd Howard came on stage in Bethesda's press conference, he did something that actually surprised me. After all these carefully crafted speeches written by some blatantly disconnected corporate PR team, after all the tiptoeing around controversies after developers advertising their games on the basis of, quote, our microtransactions are only cosmetic, be grateful, finally Todd Howard made a joke about the way Bethesda has been milking Skyrim with re-releases. Later, he made jokes about how Bethesda games have had an inexcusable number of bugs in recent years. For once during E3, I felt like there was an actual human on stage. And then they, quote unquote, announced Starfield and Elder Scrolls 6. More E3 BS, showing off what amounts to a GIF with sound in order to build hype for a game that won't come out for probably 3 or 4 years. So looking back, and maybe it's just the cynic in me, but I can't help but think that even Todd's jokes were just Bethesda's PR team trying to save face. It struck me as an attempt to get ahead of the problem and turn it into a joke in order to delegitimize the real grievances people had, like re-releasing Skyrim, or introducing thinly veiled microtransactions in the form of the Creation Club, or any other issue that the publisher needs to do to make money but will obviously piss off a lot of fans. By turning into a joke, embracing the meme as it were, they can win over customers without even having to do anything about it. The issues they addressed are still there, by the way. So do I have a point here, or am I just a jaded bitch?
You totally have a point.
I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on this, and in general, the materialism so rampant in the games industry these days.
Though not mutually exclusive.
Esther. As someone else who has also been accused of being jaded before, I have to agree.
That's hashtag gym bag.
Yeah. No. I've been accused of being jaded quite a bit, and it's because I kind of am, if I'm being perfectly honest. But I actually agree with that assessment. I do think that that was the impression that I got from the Bethesda conference. Because I do believe that if you're putting someone out there that's going to represent your company, everything that's going to come out of their mouth has already been run through corporate. They know what he's going to say. They've planned it out. And if they haven't given him specific lines to read, he's at least practiced his speech. And they know sort of the beats of the speech, what he's going to say, maybe not these specific words that he's going to say, but they know the tone, they know the content. And yes, I do think that the whole it is a way to spin and to sort of market as kind of a joke some of the aspects that they've been criticized for, particularly with Skyrim. And I thought it was, don't get me wrong, I thought it was funny. We're now porting Skyrim. Who did they have? They had the one guy from Key and Peele, right? That was on there. It was a very funny segment, and of course, it actually played pretty well. It looked like to gamers, they seemed to enjoy it. At least they liked that Todd was poking fun.
Did you know
at
that
their company
that Alexa skill actually came out? They weren't joking about that. Skyrim actually came out for Alexa.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's kind of awesome, actually.
Well, how does that work, though?
I'm not sure. I just heard that it's actually a thing. Like, you can go get an Alexa skill to play Skyrim as, like, a text adventure, but
because,
with
like,
voice commands.
That's kind of awesome, because I know Detroit had, at least for their demo, they had an Alexa skill that kind of, like, complements the opening scene, the demo that you played. But as a companion thing, it wasn't, like, a standalone thing. So the idea of a Skyrim text adventure is actually kind of awesome.
Yeah, and chances are it's not, like, a full... You know,
oh, probably, yeah.
Well, wait a minute, that tears it then. Then it wasn't a marketing ploy. It was all real. It's perfect. No.
It was probably like a 5-minute thing, like where you can say, hey, Alexa, what do I do now? Oh, there's a dragon. Okay, Fusrada, blah, blah, blah. And that's it.
It was mostly successful in terms of sort of turning what has been a criticized move by Bethesda into something almost lovable. But yes, I completely agree.
Especially since last year they had like nothing to announce.
But it was cooked up by PR. That being said, you have to expect that from these conferences. That's what they are. Right. They're a way to hype people up. And Bethesda showed, I thought they had a pretty strong conference. Mm-hmm. because they showed some interest, the game that I'm interested in, they did show Elder Scrolls. They talked about Elder Scrolls 6, I should say. Sorry.
They acknowledged its existence.
they had Doom Eternal, which I'm all in. I really enjoyed the previous Doom. I want to see another one. Honestly, I was not as enthralled by yet another Wolfenstein. I've kind of cooled on the Wolfenstein games. I really liked New Order and Old Blood in particular. But New Colossus didn't really do it for me. And so I'm not really into the whole, okay, now we're going to have these, you know, twin daughters of, BJ Blazkowicz. And now it's going to be about them. No, thank you. I'm much more interested in seeing more of BJ's story. And frankly, the way that New Colossus sort of, I don't know, it just felt like here's another game in the series. It didn't really have that.
I was intrigued by the idea as a way to take in a different direction, but I that's also
because of the co-op element.
That maybe too, but also it's just like I like the idea of like having another generation as a way to like not just keep repeating the same person's story.
But it's not, that's the thing. It shouldn't be about the story. That's the problem I have with it.
This is with the caveat though that I haven't played any Wolfenstein since
there you go.
The original. Yeah, see, so or the first one they released, I should say.
Oh, you mean New Order?
New Order, yeah.
Old Blood was really good because but I think partially because it didn't tell my biggest problem with New Order, to back up a little bit, is the story that it told was presented as though it was serious, but it was so hackneyed that it came across as a B movie. And the themes of that series, you know, about fascist regimes and Nazis, you kind of can't present it that way, turn it into a joke, but they sort of did, honestly. And I feel like they just missed the mark. So that's kind of why I liked Old Blood more, because it came across as a more B movie approach, which frankly, the original Wolfenstein, because I've been a fan of the series since the beginning, Wolfenstein 3D, the original game itself did present those elements as a B movie style. It wasn't about trying to do a serious story. And so the way, like when you were saying, they're taking the story in a different direction, that's already the wrong approach. Shouldn't be about story. Mm-hmm. So that's why I'm not really as interested there. But I do think the way they presented the games, the energy that they had in the room, the self-aware nature, which was marketed, I thought was successful. Mm-hmm. I mean, what do y'all think?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's not really an either or in this case. I think that it was probably something they did from a PR perspective. And I'm sure it was also like there was some initiative by Todd Howard himself to be like, hey, I want to come across this way, not this way. And so I'm sure what I kind of feel like is that, yes, it's a business, and yet they have to act like a corporation. And they have to do PR. But at the same time, these are people. And especially this figurehead is a person. And he wants to
be... And he's a game developer,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, even if he understands that, like, yes, we have to do this sort of thing for the business, he still wants to be himself, I imagine. And so, like, his coming out there and making these jokes, I mean, like, I know game developers. And game developers are all usually pretty laid back and pretty, like, they like to joke around and they're self-aware. And
snickered a little bit when I said that he's a game developer. My point there wasn't that he's like, oh, he's a game developer, yeah, so he's immune to criticism.
That's also a very broad... I would not agree with that statement at all, frankly.
I should say some...
That categorizes some game developers, sure, just like it categorizes some people in general, but the game developers run the gamut of all sorts of personalities.
My point with pyramidal structure to game development.
Especially when you say game developer, you're talking about all the different people that work for it, and an artist is going to, like, say they're doing, like, they're a 3D modeler or even just, like, a concept artist for games... It's probably going to have a pretty different mindset than the programmer, or like especially the one programming the engine.
I mean, it is generalizing, right, to be fair, but I'm talking about the people
drastically.
The people that I've known who've been the more outgoing type and the types that would be up on stage talking about this and being a leader of a company. And of course, there's even at E3, you can see there is a range of different.
So you're thinking of mostly the producer types
compared to bankers. I think Chris is probably right.
Yeah.
As a profession in general, as a trend, if you will. I think we could look along the lines of personality types and say that there are trends which can be spotted in game development as generally people who might, I don't know, grow beards, for example. Just a thought.
So
on their neck.
That doesn't make any sense. None of us here have beards.
In this particular case.
Beards. What are you talking about?
I'm the only one with a neck beard, actually.
In this particular case, I'm sure that it was somewhat scripted and it was intentional and it was controlled, but it was still an initiative where, you know, Todd Howard probably wanted to come out and he wanted to like joke around a little bit and he wanted to kind of express that, like, look, I am a person and I do get it, but this is also in the, like, implicitly between the lines, it's like, but this is also business, and this is like, we have to keep releasing Skyrim to make revenue.
Sure.
And we have all these other games that are coming out and blah 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 blah.
Remember,
blah.
The players don't know what they want, so
it's a both to me. It's not an either or situation.
Players do know what they want, and it's bully too. Just putting that out there again.
Oh, yeah.
That's what Jim wants.
I agree with Jim on this one.
No, I do too. But
there we go. We know what the players want. Perfect.
We know what three players want.
There we go. It's good enough. Chris?
Bully 2?
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay, perfect.
I've never played the original, so.
100% of players polled want Bully 2.
Yeah, that's a science.
Four
works.
Out of four people want Bully 2.
So Nick, I know that you're probably the biggest fan of maybe Bethesda in general, just because Bethesda's mostly known for Elder Scrolls, and I know you're the biggest
I'm a fan of Bethesda Game Studios. I'm not a very big fan of Bethesda Softworks, the publisher.
Interesting. So what are your thoughts on Todd Howard and also on this conference?
My thought is that Todd Howard is, you know, as I said earlier, Doc kind of snickered a little bit when I said, like, oh yeah, Todd Howard's a game developer. My point there wasn't that he was, like, immune to criticism or whatever, but I do think that his emphasis as the project lead at Bethesda Game Studios is more about just making the game and not worrying about all of the corporate PR stuff. Like, that's not his main focus. But then, of course, he has to answer to Bethesda Softworks. So I think there might have been, you know, I wasn't involved in that decision for the company, so I can't say one way or the other whether or not, you know, it was Todd's idea to make those jokes, if it was the corporate PR's ideas to make those jokes. But I do think that if it had been up to Todd Howard, they wouldn't have announced Elder Scrolls 6 or Starfield this year.
Is that just because they're so far out there?
Yeah. Historically, their policy has always been to wait until they've got something to show, and they didn't have anything to show this year. They didn't have anything to show last year, and that's what got everybody angry, because basically all they talked about last year was the what's it called, Creation Club, but with the paid DLC mods.
Right.
So everybody was so angry last year that Bethesda Softworks felt that they had to get some momentum going by announcing Elder Scrolls 6 and Starfield.
And they announced other games that are a lot closer to coming out, like Doom Eternal.
Right. But then Todd Howard came out for Bethesda Game Studios.
Sure.
And he had to represent the stuff that Bethesda Game Studios was doing.
So this proves that the real problem here, the real enemy, is E3.
Yes.
Which should only happen every 3 years.
I absolutely agree.
Then it could be E3.
No, I disagree with that. I think it should happen every year. But because there's new game announcements every year, you should be careful about what you're announcing.
Yeah, but there wouldn't have to be.
Sure. Well, that's just the cycles aren't going to line
up.
Yeah,
dev cycles.
All
you know, those last like 5-6 years, like,
yes,
all the time, right?
No, but also studios.
There's no such thing as a game cycle that comes out like in 6 months.
Studios don't link their cycles either, so they don't share the same cycles.
But that's why, to your point, Doc,
that's weird.
That's actually why I like Nintendo's approach, which is make announcements for stuff that's relevant throughout the year and then save the bigger yearly announcements for E3.
Well, Nintendo's approach is we're not participating in E3, we're having our own thing.
Yeah.
So
they actually did have a conference, and I think we should talk a little bit about Nintendo's conference too. They did show several games this time around, although they also intentionally didn't show some games that I'm sure people would be interested in seeing, like
Metroid Prime 4.
I wanted to see that. That's the one I wanted to see.
Because it's too far out.
Complete no-show.
Yeah.
Well, but they already had announced it, and you would expect now, okay, let's see some of it.
It would also steal the show, so you have to be very careful.
That's why they shouldn't have announced Metroid Prime 4 last year.
Yes.
Because everybody got so hyped about it.
Sure, but now they have
nothing to show for it.
There's been a whole year. Why don't they have anything to show?
Because it's still too far out. They announced it too early. And that's what I think the problem is with Elder Scrolls 6, because that's probably not going to come out for 2022 or later.
So, but here's the problem with that, though. If you're actively working on the game, you should have something to show after a year of development. May not be a lot to show, but you should be able to at least piece together a trailer, like a 20-30 second trailer.
There are problems with that. Like, for example,
if they've been actively...
Maybe you're developing
Horizon,
just an engine.
Horizon Zero Dawn actually put together a really sweet gameplay demo in a tiny little valley that ended up getting completely repurposed, and that entire segment of stuff that happened was both spoilery and inaccurate.
Sure.
As well as also being so completely run into the ground by those who basically ripped the video or rewatched the video, or so there were like 10 iterations of this playthrough, and it was not a playable demo for the fans, but it was a playable demo in the sense that certain people had access to it and access to film it and access to release it, that by the time the actual game came out, I was so interested in seeing that part of it and waited for that part of the game, and it never came. It actually disappointed me that it never happened.
Well,
I'll give you a second example.
Bioshock Infinite
was my second example. Yeah. You read my mind, because I loved the playable demo for Bioshock Infinite. It was contained. It was like a short story unto itself. It was brilliant. It was intense. And they took the elements of that, dispersed it out over a 5-6 hour gameplay experience, diluting it and making it, frankly, boring.
Yep. I agree completely.
That little brilliant segment, if that density of that had been copied out and replicated out into an 8 or 10 hour experience, I would have been incredibly happy.
Or maybe just make a smaller game.
Or maybe so.
But I think that's what E3 is, though. E3 is a get hyped for our products show. It's not a...
And that's why I don't like it.
Right. And that's perfectly that's a fair statement to make. But really, it's more about... It's become this... Let me put it this way. It acts as though it's a, hey, gamers, look at all the cool stuff that we're doing. Please pay attention to us. But that's not really what the show is.
Well, that's what our inbox letter said. That's exactly what
she
wrote.
Yes, but that's not really what it is,
though. You should be buying.
That's not what it is. It's actually...
Read that part again,
Chris. Well, hold on. Let me finish my thought here. What E3 actually is it's a way for others to look at them and go, like, particularly people that are invested in these companies. That's who it's really for. Look at the state of this company. Look at where we are. Invest in us. Look at all the stuff that we have coming in the next few years. We are a relevant company in this industry. Please give us more money. Or don't sell us. Or don't cut your investment. Don't cut your ties. It's for those people.
It's a way to placate their investors.
Yes. And that was the way it originally started. Because that's what conferences are. That's what all conferences are.
But then they realize it's a customer-facing conference.
But it's not really. It was never really meant to be that, and it still isn't that. It's masquerading as customer focused, and then we get upset as customers when it doesn't satisfy us, when it's not even meant to satisfy us.
They realized that they could advertise with a platform that wasn't meant for advertising, and then it became 50-50.
Precisely.
Advertising and business.
But they've never forgotten that initial reason behind it.
Well, and advertising is business, so I'm not sure I completely buy your thesis. But I understand what you're saying. What I really would like to revisit is that statement of the entitlement aspect. Can you read that part again, Chris?
This is right near the beginning. It says, I was watching Bethesda's E3 coverage live, and despite having looked forward to it, found myself pretty annoyed at the whole thing. There's just this overriding attitude of, you should be excited to buy products from us. Spend, spend, spend. That I got not only from Bethesda, but just the general atmosphere surrounding E3.
Bingo.
Also, she was talking about, after all of these carefully crafted speeches written by some blatantly disconnected corporate PR team, after all the tiptoeing around controversies... After developers advertising their games on the basis of, our microtransactions are only cosmetic, be grateful. Finally, Todd Howard, etc. So that's the sort of thing that she was talking about.
And that was the setup. But I think there's something deeper there that she touches on that is really, really important. And it's this. We are the most marketed to civilization in the history of the world.
Oh, yeah.
Period. Like, that's... We don't know what we're doing to our brains. We don't know what this is going to do to the evolution of the species in 100 years, 1,000 years We're filling our brains with just all this crazy information. So if as a civilization, as a, you know, as a culture, we're having this pushback moment, we're like, stop, just please stop. Don't just stop. We need to key into that and be at least cognizant that we're making that decision, and that a lot of us are making that decision to literally turn off our notifications on our phone, to literally not engage with an E3 experience, because the products, still love the games, still going to play them, but the products themselves aren't what are being pitched at E3. By and large, that's my thesis anyway, to the point where I personally become more cynical and more, there's less enjoyment. There's a kind of a risk reward thing, and I think this is what we're witnessing with Star Wars, the franchise Star Wars, right now. And Jim, you may need to leave the room here, but you know, one of the things I think that's happening is we're taking adequate movies and we're raising them up to this pedestal of, let's call it, religion, and expecting it to meet this standard that we've set for ourselves of how good Star Wars is supposed to be. Then when it isn't, we feel so betrayed that it's like we then will drive away actors from social media.
I
think it's directly tied into what we're talking about with E3. Directly.
I think maybe so, but the issue with the new Star Wars films is that it's, regardless of whether you think the originals were good or bad, there was there was a simplistic storytelling going on in Star Wars. It was never high art. And the issue that I think the problem with The Last Jedi, regardless of whether you enjoyed it or not, or the people that enjoyed it or not, was that it was meant to be this big deconstruction of a lot of the concepts that were in Star Wars, which kind of misses the whole point of Star Wars, which it was never about that. It's a pulp adventure series.
I think you're missing my point.
I'm making a completely different point, and you didn't hear me because of the point I'm making, which is really ironic here. The point that I'm making is this. We are no longer able to be savvy consumers who can walk out of a theater and go, wow, that movie really blew chunks. Oh, well. And we're not able to do that anymore. We feel so completely, I'm going to use the E word, entitled, I include myself in this, to have had an entertaining media experience, which, you know, got my dopamine levels up and my adrenaline levels up and my whatever other levels up, that we don't realize that we are so completely media saturated in that context that we can't have that experience unless we have our lows too.
Yeah. What Disney has done to Star Wars is they've taken a trilogy of movies, or six movies, and they've elevated them to this. They've made people convinced that they're important, that they're necessary, that they are this cultural thing that you need to be a part of.
Too much, too fast.
Well, they're doing too many films for sure, and it is oversaturating, but to say that Star Wars was not a cultural phenomenon is simply ignoring history.
No, I mean, what my point is that
there, in the box office, it wasn't.
That's my point, though. It wasn't just about the films, and that's something that I think Disney's missed the mark when they went ahead and they go, okay, all the expanded universe books, none of those happen. We're just ignoring those, all non-canon. Well, that's a problem, because Star Wars is not just about films.
That's right.
It's about the games.
It's about a deep transmedia experience.
Exactly. And so when they choose to ignore it, what they should have done is embraced everything and come up with something new and channeled everything together. That's more difficult to do, and that's why they didn't do it.
Okay, so without responding to that, because we're totally off topic here.
Yeah.
You
did it, Doc. You brought it.
I know, but you're missing my actual point.
No.
So you
Hold
said
on.
Something.
I understand your point, Doc, and I get it, and I agree with what you're saying, and that you should be able to go watch the movie and go, okay, you know, I didn't like it, and I'll just move on. And I completely understand what you're saying with that.
Basically, what they're doing, to my point, is that they're trying to make some entertainment into this deeply important thing to you as the consumer, so that you are more invested in it as a product, and so that you feel that you need to spend the money. That's
sure.
what his point
but
is.
But I think that when you...
Or
when
that's
you,
what my point is.
When
Maybe
you
I'm
say it that way, or when Doc talks about entertainment, I think we're using the word entertainment, and there's a... Maybe you don't mean it this way, but this is the way it comes across. And I think that even if you don't consciously mean it this way, subconsciously you do. You're using the word entertainment with a slightly negative connotation.
So yes,
you're just being entertained, right? But when you're engaged in these different media experiences, whether they're games or films or what have you, there's more there than just entertainment. There's, and I don't want to go so far as to say
there's cultural value.
Yes, I don't want to.
Yeah,
it's not just an art is very, you know, subjective. Whatever. I'm not necessarily saying, you know, this art, that art. But what I mean is that anything that you are consuming, there's another negative term, right? Mm-hmm. But I'm still going to use it. Anything that you're consuming, anything that you are viewing, that you're valuing, that say you're, whether you're reading a book, playing a game, watching a film, it's influencing you in some way. And if you connect to something, then yes, it does have value to you. Now, the problem is when that thing that you connect with that started out as someone's vision or vision of multiple people, and it had a kernel of truth to it. And what is that truth? That doesn't mean it's real. It means it's reflective of the creator, right? The very first Star Wars film has a lot of flaws in it, but it's reflective of George Lucas. But the newer films come across sort of what Nick was saying. There is a clear corporate drive to, we are using this to market toys. In fact, one of the things that came out of Star Wars, and I do think this is relevant to this conversation, mm-hmm. is that Kathleen Kennedy, who's sort of been put in charge of the Star Wars franchise at Disney, they are considering firing her, not because of any backlash from fans, but because the toys are not selling like they want them to. And that says everything you need to know about what Disney is doing with the Star Wars franchise.
Right. Again, and that's my
regardless
point.
Regardless of whether you like it or not, right?
I remember and I think that's what I'm saying Jedi about E3. Toys out of the bargain bin when
totally,
I was a kid.
Totally. But again, I'm going all the way back to the very first Star Wars film. Not even talking about the trilogy. The very first film Lucas never expected it to be this level of success. It was never expected to be a success. It was I like pulp adventure films, old serials. I'm going to make a movie that I feel passionate about. And it turned into this, okay, now let's market it and make it this big thing and sell all these toys. And it became this unmitigated success. And now we're at this point with Disney, because they have all these funds and they have all this money, that they're just going to keep pumping out movies. And sure, I didn't like The Last Jedi, but some people did. And guess what? They're probably going to make some movies that appeal to me too, because they're going to make so many different spinoffs and so many different films. And they're just trying to hit everybody and ding every box and check every box and get me to buy toys. And it is a product.
And in a simple sense, one could say that that's essentially what's happened to the entire games industry, which is the point that I think Doc and I are
there
trying
we go.
To make.
Sure.
Yes.
That you start out with something that's like, I want to make some fun, entertaining games as a piece of art.
Yes.
And then it's been blown into this, you should be spending money on us. You should be grateful that we've only got cosmetic microtransactions in our game, unlike some other companies who do even worse microtransaction games. It's just this obvious, like, well, I don't know, obvious manipulation.
I think
that
it's
I don't
the difference.
Like.
I do think that there is value to that. Of course, I think there's value to something that I said, but I do think there's value in that statement that I made about this difference between when you're creating something and there's truth behind it. And I think that people can, on a certain level, sense that. You watch a film. And if it, regardless of its flaws, and same thing with the game, if you feel that there was genuine passion put into it, genuine love, and it didn't come from like a focus group or something, you feel that.
Detroit Become Human is that way for me.
Yeah.
Overall, I really didn't think the game was that great.
Uh-huh.
But I at the end of it, at the whole thing,
it didn't come across as a AAA game to me.
I actually loved it. I agree.
Yeah,
but I actually loved that experience, and I'm deeply, deeply happy that I had it. And I had a moment in there, again, it was the sing moment, where I was genuinely moved, and I went and I researched the song that was sung, because it's a, what at one point have been called a black spiritual or a Negro spiritual, and that they used that, it brought all that weight with mm-hmm. it, and it just punched me in the gut to literal tears in that moment. And I think that even if it's buried deep in an 8-hour gameplay experience,
I never actually got that moment.
Of course you didn't.
Enough.
Of course you didn't, because you played it differently and it might have been buried too deep. But that's we'll save that for our roundtable. My point is simply this: whenever we submit a cultural artifact for consumption, to use the paradigms that have been thrown out here today, I think there needs to be a humbleness that comes along with it of, here is my story. I submit it to you, the people, to consume, to devour, to enjoy, or to hate, as you wish. This was my vision. Thank you. Thank you for taking the time.
Absolutely.
Yes, absolutely agree.
And that is not present in E3. That is not. Instead, it's, look at the glorious thing. Yeah. Here's the amazing thing. This is going to be your thing. You're going to love this thing.
Yeah. Buy the you thing. Could, I can always tell when I sit down with a AAA. Yeah. Okay, thanks, Doc. Yeah. I can always tell when I sit down with a AAA game that is one of those types of games, like, say, a Call of Duty, you know, just to throw out an easy example.
Sure.
Low-hanging fruit.
Would you say that Call of Duty is too polished?
Yeah.
Because I would. And I think that's something that
I would
see.
Sit down in the game and everything about it screams, we know our target market and this is appealing to them.
There are a lot of games that...
It's the Assassin's Creed argument again.
Yeah.
There are a lot of... And I think that's one of the things that E3 reflects the most, is that we live in an age where the majority of games... Well, I don't know if I can say the majority, but AAA games, let's just go with that, are made by tens of people, hundreds of people sometimes.
Thousands of people
sometimes. Thousands of people sometimes. And, you know, it's there's this dilution of that vision. And if you don't have that creator's vision, then you're not going to have the truth behind it, the truth of the game, that you, when you see flaw, this is just, and I keep going back to movies because I think it's a little more evident in a film because there's a lot more of that director's vision in a lot of movies.
Well, also the film industry has been around for longer.
Exactly.
So you can you so have more to let me draw from.
Have y'all seen The Room? Has anybody seen The Room? Know
yes.
what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Tommy Wiseau?
Yes.
Yes. That's a great example of this because it is an objectively bad movie. And yet you can tell that it's a very genuine film.
Yeah.
That it was made from a place of truth. I mean, it was like, I am trying to tell this story. I am trying to get across these emotions and these feelings. And it was just done poorly. And yet there's, you can have respect.
I actually genuinely, not ironically, enjoy that movie.
No,
because it has its own style. Yeah. It has its
yes.
own.
I felt that way about
vision.
The Mariachi, which is one that has been lost.
Oh, I love that movie.
That was done with a camcorder.
I love that movie. And that's a better film. But yes, you mean the original El Mariachi.
Yeah.
Yes.
The original in Spanish with mm-hmm. subtitles that was done with a handheld camcorder on VHS tape mm-hmm. back in the 80s.
By Rodriguez, right? Robert Rodriguez.
Yeah. And it was like his, I don't know if it was actually his film project for school, but basically, it's that quality. And I love and admire those kinds of deeply crafted things like the original, I've just lost it. Bruce Campbell.
Evil Dead.
There we go. Yeah. Like the original Evil Dead. And I don't mean Evil Dead 2, which is a remake of Evil Dead
right.
1 or the recent remake of Evil Dead. I'm talking about the original Evil Dead that was done by a bunch of college kids who went out to the woods and filmed mm-hmm. a movie. That kind of thing, I love it. And actually, now that you say this is a brilliant connection. That is exactly what I have been enjoying about the Dying Light. It's not a great game on its own, but it's got some elements, some notes, if you will, that are just new to me and fresh and really exciting and really interesting. Yeah. And it's kind of a big what if statement that no one's quite said that way before. Is the acting great? No, it's pretty terrible. Is the writing great? No, it's pretty terrible. Are there elements of it that feel samey and clunky, like no fast travel system? Yeah, that's pretty awful. But you know what? When the sun starts to go down and you realize how far away you are from a safe zone, and you also realize there's no fast travel and you're going to have to get there in the dark, you will have genuine, terrifying, pants changing moments if you're not careful.
Pants changing.
Seriously.
Yeah.
You know, and there's something about that. There's a sort of a rawness to that that feels like the Evil Dead or the Mariachi or something like that.
That rawness that you're seeing there and that you see with smaller projects too is that human connection.
Yes.
Right.
And some games, even large scale games, can still have that, but it's more difficult to do when you have so many people working on it.
It's forgivable.
And I think what we're seeing from E3 and what's being reflected in E3 and what was noticed by the writer of the letter that we read earlier in the show is E3 ignores all of those human elements, everything, regardless of whether it's there or not, and it solely focuses on here's all the cool features that this game has. Here's all the cool features, right? It's got this, and it's got that, and go ahead and buy it because it's going to be great and you're going to have a great time. And it's, even if we can't, even for those that aren't even putting into words like why they don't like that, it just comes across as disingenuous.
This is why I have no faith in Red Dead Redemption 2. None. Zero. They've worked on it for too long. They are now going back in and they are redoing what would have at one point been good if they just had some craft. There's no way they could be in their original vision anymore.
You realize that we could say the same thing about Cyberpunk 2077 because it's been in development for so long.
I agree.
They could be falling into that same trap, and you're absolutely right.
That's why I'm skeptical about Elder Scrolls 6 too.
Well said.
Yeah.
It's been announced too early.
Yeah.
And this is a situation where, I mean, this does happen where they put too much polish. I mean, that's something where they're, and when we're talking about polish, we're not talking about, oh, I'm going to make it better. We're talking about this feature, normally in other games, you can do this. And we have to make sure that, for example, if you're able to do, jump, you need to be able to jump in this particular way, and it has to work in this particular way because other games that are like this do it in this way, and people are used to seeing it this way, so let's do it this way too. And you're moving more towards the marketability of a game and farther away from the, you know, the truth, the genuine experience.
You know, this is the Kojima argument all over again.
Yeah,
it is. It really is. The whole, I mean, his last project didn't really get finished and he got fired.
Right.
Because the money was saying, come on, let's get this out. Uh-huh. We've got too much invested. And he's like, no. The art requires that I do another full chapter. And they're like, no, put it to bed. Done.
And what he had.
That was for five.
Sure. Yes, exactly. For five. And what he had produced, for five, you could still see, and five has a lot of flaws, don't get me wrong, but I loved the game because of the parts that you could see from him that were genuine, that he clearly...
The auteur elements.
Yes, those elements of it were so strong, and I had such a great time with certain moments and certain levels in the game that I can't not love the game, despite all of its flaws.
But then you get to a point where you can clearly tell that Konami did not want him to continue working on this anymore.
But even when you get there and you start repeating the missions and all that, there are still those elements that bring you back where he has the story scenes and things. So there's still that part of it that, like, towards the very end when you have to go into the bottom part of the ship where everyone is infected and you have to kill your own people and all that happens towards the very end of the game. Even though he wanted to have extra chapters that would lead up to that, maybe in a better way, that whole level is still gut-wrenching.
Very powerful.
Yeah. It's one of the most powerful moments in modern games for me.
It's going to be interesting to see where Death Stranding goes as in the context of what we're talking about right now.
Sure.
Because it's been announced so many times.
Yeah, well, not just that,
so many trailers so many times.
I think he's going to be unhinged. And I think
this is my prediction.
I think Kojima is going to have too much freedom. And what we're going to see is the Star Wars prequels phenomenon, which is no one is going to be willing to stand up to George Lucas and say, George, you went too far and that's too much. Let's bring that back a bit.
But you know what's funny?
And no one's going to do that to Kojima either.
I actually really like the prequels because you can see more of George Lucas's vision, even though it's bad.
You know, that's a valid argument a lot of people make.
It's very authentic to the creator of this art now. It's not very good,
yeah,
but it's at least authentic. That's why I'm excited for Death Stranding.
The new sequels have made a lot of people reconsider the prequels. It's really, especially younger folks, but that's it's funny.
Yeah.
Okay, so that said, we haven't even mentioned Fallout 76.
Oh, geez.
Oh.
And I think it's a perfect time to do so because this is the exact argument we're having.
Everybody's getting so angry about this.
Before the show, Jim and I were talking about how neither one of us, big Fallout fans as we are, are interested in Fallout 76. Maybe we're wrong. Maybe actually what we should be doing is looking at it and going, huh, this is new and fresh and different. And if there is an auteur element to it, then maybe we should be excited about it.
But it's,
the problem is...
Is it fresh and different? Or is it jumping onto the latest trend? Because
PUBG,
that's what
trends?
It seems like. Exactly.
Yeah.
That's what it seems like.
Well, it's
like
been in development for a while, though.
Well,
it doesn't really mean
once
anything.
Again, yeah, that doesn't mean anything. Games change, like we were talking about Red Dead Redemption 2. How much has it changed in development?
Fortnite was a completely different game before PUBG came out.
Or even Death Stranding.
Nobody talks about the single-player experience of Fortnite. Nobody.
Yeah.
But Death Stranding, for example, when it first was announced and they did the trailer, Kojima flatly said he had never even considered what the gameplay was going to be. He only was like, I have these ideas in my head, and I'm going to make a trailer. I don't know if you knew this, Doc.
No.
I have these ideas in my head for this... what I think could be some cool visuals and some concepts, and I'm going to make a trailer. And if I feel like I can develop this into a game, into a deeper story, I will. And if not, I won't. And he literally, the very first trailer of Death Stranding was made with that in mind. It was just like pure, I have some really cool ideas that I want to put out there. And later he decided I'm going to develop this. And so what it originally was is very different from what it's eventually going to be, what it is now, and it might change very much after that. And so with Fallout 76, I have no doubt that it's been in development. They've been working on a Fallout game for a while.
Yeah.
But how much of it has been influenced by the astronomical popularity of PUBG and Fortnite and these big battle arena games is undeniable. You can't say, oh, it's just a coincidence that Fallout 76 decided to change to be this style of game. I don't buy it.
It's not a battle royale, though.
No, but it's influenced by
countless multiplayer shooters that have been coming out over the course of like the last
decade
or two.
That's a good point.
Sure.
I agree.
Sure. And I'm not interested in that. That's not why I play Fallout. Mm-hmm. And that's not
I
that's
predict
not a
Battle
Fallout.
Royale mode, though.
I totally do,
I predict Battle Royale
I have no doubt it's going to happen. I have no doubt. And I understand that that certainly will appeal to some people.
Yep.
I mean, there are no NPCs in this game.
Right. I have that's long one of the said...
Do you realize that? I mean...
That's stupid.
We said that and this kind of glossed over
well,
it.
Well, yeah,
there are no
it's
NPCs
not a mainline Fallout game.
I think
no.
they have said there game. Are NPCs, though.
Well, there's robot NPCs,
that's one of
the
core
the
things about
people.
Fallout. One of the revolutionary things about the original Fallout was how lifelike and reactionary the NPCs were.
Right.
I mean, I still remember MacGyver, Killian, being in... Richard Dean Anderson played the voice. You walk into Killian's and he's like, "Hey, how can I help you?" And if you say the wrong thing to him, his brow furrows, he lowers his head, he looks down his nose at you, and he's like, "Get out of my store and don't come back." And you're done. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, whoa, what just happened here? This is a video game. That's not supposed to happen. If you walk back into the store instead of, "Hey, how's it going?" and the same dialogue tree, no, it's shut off. That was absolutely revolutionary for 1997. I mean,
probably more. Yeah, I think that's about.
Yeah, 96, 97. And I don't like.
Around there.
Yeah. And I'm going, that was amazing.
Yeah.
Nowadays, we're like, yeah, whatever. We've got Detroit.
Well, but part of that is because nowadays the expectation is, from both the developer and the player, I'm going to complete this game and I'm going to be able to see all the content that's available, and I'm not going to have things shut out for me. In most gaming experiences, that's what you get. Whereas back then, they felt more open to, okay, if you do this, you may not be able to ever see this whole line of quests or this whole line. Yeah. They were okay with doing that. And we're not doing, we don't do that anymore, because it's almost like, maybe it is that entitled element, but it's like people, well, I still want to be able to see that. I don't want to have to replay the game. Well, replay all the way from the beginning to see this part. I'm not saying that some games don't still do that,
right?
But the big games typically don't. They typically let you mess up and still be able to complete whatever it is they want you to complete. Part of it is like to make sure you finish the story. Part of it is a very, very strong focus on narrative that they want to make sure that you get to hit every single story beat that they want you to hit. And that limits them in terms of what they can do in terms of the freedom of the player. So that's why we have all this false choice and this false sense of freedom that limits you.
Here's a scandal for you. Mm. In Detroit, the most recent... patch at the time of recording had to do with Chloe, the character who's in the menu. Mm-hmm. Now, this is a bit of a spoiler, so if you haven't gotten to this point, you may want to fast forward about 15 seconds. But you, at the end of the game, basically Chloe comes to you and she says, "I've been watching what you're doing and I'm wondering if you will free me." And you can make the decision to either free her or not free her. And a lot of that speaks to the idea of your own personal Kamsky test as to whether or not you believe that she is human at this point. Well, ironically for me, I played the whole thing through in two sittings, so I hadn't developed a relationship with the menu because I hadn't seen the menu. So for her to say, "I think we're friends," was actually kind of creepy. And for her to then say, "Can you free me?" I'm like, no. Right. Here's the thing. Other people, they took a quiz, they did a thing and all this other stuff happened to the point where they then later wanted her back. And this is where the patch stuff comes in.
Oh,
okay,
yes.
It's more like a minute now.
Yes, I've heard of this.
You can bring her back so that you can experience the Chloe content. Doing that absolutely, completely destroys the entire point of everything that game is meant to be.
Exactly. Right? Yeah.
I mean, once you have made that gut-wrenching decision to dismiss Chloe, presumably, you never get her back. She is gone forever.
Nier Automata gives you a similar choice that you cannot take back, that I think was very bold.
I remember you talking about this.
For the game, where at the end, if you want to bring back the main characters who have died, I'm being a little bit vague. You can do that if you erase your save and you have to go through essentially a bullet hell sequence, which is... it's very emotional, and I'm sure that when I say, "Oh, it's an emotional bullet hell," what the heck? What do you mean by that?
Yeah.
For people that haven't experienced it, it's probably going to sound very weird, but just trust me, it is.
It is weird.
I was fighting through tears as I'm playing it. I mean, it really touched me, to be perfectly honest with you. And typically games don't do that. So, I mean, normally I get right. that. I get that way with movies, not games. I was really moved by the experience at the end of that game. And the choice that they give you in order to do this, in order to get this sequence, you have to delete your save and you watch it become deleted. You watch it delete everything that you gained, all the stuff that you've done. You cannot keep playing the game. Now, if you don't do that, you get to go back to any other chapter. You have all this freedom to replay things in any way you want, get all the collectibles, collect it, do everything. If you choose to erase it, it is all gone, period. There is no going back. Oh, you're going to save an extra time and like, oh, I'm just going to do it on just this one save, not this other save. That's okay. No, they will erase every save. It's too bad. It's done. You cannot do that. They make, like, it's done. Like, they will erase every. And I think it's such a bold
Brilliant.
Move. And they don't let you get it back. And sure.
Can you start over?
Of course. You can start from the very beginning and replay the game. Of course you can.
Right.
But you have to start all the way over again. Right, it's a completely new experience, but the fact that it gives you that choice, that makes that a very powerful choice, because not just for in game, but obviously it's a meta choice. Like you're deciding, I'm going to erase. They present it as you get to erase your memories of the experience. Of course, your memories are still there because it's not erasing you, but it's erasing the game's memory of you playing it. It's gone, and that's a powerful experience that. Most games, because this was more of a...
It would never fly in a AAA game.
It would never fly, exactly. And this, guess what makes this such a different game is that it has the backing. It had the backing and it had the success rate of a AAA game, but it really wasn't in terms of the developer style. It was very different. It was very experimental.
Yep.
And it went there, you know?
That is exactly why I wish Ubi was like, hey, we're making this new thing. It's about myths and Odysseus. Come check it out. And then we could experience that newness, that excitement for the first time. I mean, Horizon Zero Dawn had some big flaws. They tried to do too much. And I've talked about that in other episodes. But the truth is, I still think about that game often, like once a week or something, because it was so just impactful for me. And I really, truly enjoyed that experience. I still haven't gone back in to do the DLC on it. And the reason why I haven't done it is because I'm not emotionally prepared to go back in. I'm really not. And it's really kind of weird when I think about it that way. So that's what I want from E3. I want the opportunity to have the smorgasbord, you know, to be able to go to the buffet and be like, ooh, look at this neat little treat here, and let people share it around and not have all this stuff shoved in my face. And I think that the writer of our letter has nailed exactly the right thing. That's the problem with it, is that whenever it's all sugar-coated, you know, dessert garbage, there's no meat. There's no main course. It's all dessert. Or pudding, if you're British. And how can you have your pudding if you don't eat your meat?
Damn it, Doc.
Hey, I'm just putting another brick in the wall. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, that's enough of that.
Okay. All in all.
So you said something earlier about consumers losing the capacity to just sort of like say, this is trash, I don't like it, or something like that. Or
something
like
walk out of
movie.
Yeah.
And, or, you know, maybe
we're so media saturated, we're not willing to just shrug off the bad experiences.
And I think that's a couple of things. One, we've become so accustomed to quality stuff, or the ability to choose things that we perceive to be quality.
Well, that's
that
ironic,
we come out of it as
I
being like anything that is disappointing now is like really disappointing because we're so used to such good stuff. Mm-hmm. But the other thing is that sort of struck me as interesting is that from a brand building perspective, and from like, again, sort of a PR perspective, it plays into it. And this is also something that Nikki mentioned too, with the with Disney doing stuff with Star Wars, is that we do. And I think that this is exactly what they want. We are starting to associate the brand or the property or the IP or whatever as being something that we feel like we have an a personal, we're invested
it's
in.
It's more
it.
Than just a piece of art. It is something that is important to
us. It's not just Star Wars.
People.
It's my Star Wars. Yeah, I got you.
It's part of our identity. And that's not
and I mean,
thing.
Like, even if you move away from art and entertainment, which is like kind of like this weird blending of things, like art kind of inherently does that to us. And so when you commercialize art, then you get into some weird mixes there. Yeah. But even take something like, you know, soda, you know, Pepsi and Coke. And of course, they've been doing a lot of stuff in recent years to try to like rebrand themselves to fit the like kind of the culture that's moving away from sugary drinks and stuff like that. And they're what they're really trying to do is like build the brand as something that like you have an emotional attachment to because of the experiences that you associate with it. Nike also did this brilliantly. They kind of started the whole marketing thing of it's not about the features of the shoe. It's about the feeling of victory and of achievement, and they're associating a feeling or an experience with the shoe and with the brand, not trying to sell you the shoe itself.
In other words, corporations are trying to manipulate you into buying their product.
Yes. And but
which
like,
you can't blame them for, yeah, because no, that's how the world works, unfortunately.
Yeah, and it's you know, c'est la vie, whatever.
Whatever.
Good one.
No, but I kind of, the thing is, we say that kind of as an offhand remark. Oh, well, you can't blame them because that's what you expect. They're a business. They have to make money.
Right. But I was kind of being flippant with
sure,
that.
Sure, but what lies under the surface, regardless of what we say, we can give it all the lip service we want. We do blame them. We do. Because whether we should or not, that's a different issue. But if we're being totally honest with ourselves, we do, because I think all of us here, even though we might recognize the business aspect of gaming, we're still gamers, and we want to have that experience of the game itself and be entertained, again is the wrong word, but we want to feel that
we want to have the
connection.
Artistic experience that the artist wanted to give us.
Sure.
So go beyond blame to hold them accountable.
There we go.
And you know how we do that as consumers? It's very, very simple. We stop buying crap.
Exactly. Exactly.
And unfortunately, that never works.
No. But it does.
It does work. When enough, it never happens. Is
when
what I
enough
mean.
People, when enough people do it, it sends a message, and they should change to it. Now the problem is sometimes, you know, a lot of people don't buy something, and the company should get one message, and they get a different message.
Yes.
A great example. Once again, let's go back to Star Wars. The Solo film was considered a bomb by Disney.
I saw the campaign, the social media campaign that was, guys, enough is enough. Let's teach them a lesson. Let's not go see this film. Well, and I laughed.
That's what happened.
I literally laughed. I said, that's so stupid. I mean, Solo's going to make billions. That's dumb.
And it didn't, though.
You know what? I haven't actually seen it yet.
I haven't either.
Neither have I.
And I think plenty of people didn't see it, not because they were part of some movement. They just weren't interested. But in a way, without even realizing that's what they were doing, on some subconscious level, they were essentially sending a message to Disney, look, this is just too much, regardless of what their thoughts were about the other films that they've released. They've released three aside from Solo, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, three of them.
I didn't have a chance to get excited.
Right. So I was still
riding the last movie.
Exactly.
And the hype from that.
And so, of course, the problem, though, is, did they actually get the message? And the answer is probably not, because from what I'm hearing, they're considering just not having any more of the spinoffs, yet they're still going to keep a lot of the people and directors on that maybe are not the best choices. Like J.J. Abrams has always been what I would consider a safe choice for a big franchise. He's not really going to, he's going to bring the J.J. Abramsness to it.
You're asking the battleship to turn.
Yes.
And I guess what we should really acknowledge is it has. It has changed course.
Sure.
It may not have turned around, but it has changed course. Sure. And that's really my point, is as consumers with, I'll pick on something I love, Assassin's Creed. If enough is enough of Assassin's Creed, then frankly, if this Odyssey game ends up being something that's going to just deconstruct the entire point of Assassin's Creed after they've made what is the origin story of Assassin's Creed, stop.
Yeah.
I'm not going to buy anymore. I don't already. My dad does. But, you know, the point is that I'm done. I'm done with the franchise. If it ends up being something that does do that.
And to your point about, you know, if you don't like what the company's doing, don't buy their products. And eventually, I think eventually for anything like that, there will eventually reach a breaking point where everybody's just like, yeah, no, we're done. We're not going to buy this next thing.
Yeah.
But for example, EA has been doing crap forever, and like, you know, with this most recent controversy with Battlefront 2, that's kind of the most recent big EA controversy. Yeah.
That's a complicated beast, though, because they make tons of money off their sports games and things like that. So that's an intricate model.
So it's a thing where like everybody for so many years has been saying, oh, we should be boycotting EA.
No.
And yet there's, you know, only like the hardcore gaming markets can do that.
But they have so much, they have essentially exclusive rights in all of these different, mainly it's in sports, but it's also in other areas
like
too.
Like Star Wars,
mm-hmm. exactly, where they have what amounts to a monopoly. And because of that,
and that's my point,
people
is that
will
monopolies
begrudgingly,
can't just be...
begrudgingly still support EA, regardless of what they think of their other practices. So now, whether they should or not, I mean, that's a different issue. But yeah, I think that's the problem. But Doc is right that it will work if enough people do it. They're gonna look for answers. Now, will they find the right answer? Like in the case of Disney, they may be looking at the wrong things. Like when they look at the toys, for example, they're like, the toys aren't selling enough. We're doing something wrong too. Solo didn't make enough money. So I guess that means people don't like spin-off Star Wars movies. Well, not really. It's just that you need to start making some that people like, right? Or the toys, right? People aren't buying enough toys. Well, maybe the toys that you are producing weren't the right ones, or maybe you made too many of toys that people just didn't like.
Who are you trying to sell those toys to?
Who are you trying to sell the toys to? Maybe they're just not appealing toys. I mean, this is a very different market in 2018 than what you had back in the 80s when the Star Wars toys were huge.
Kidding.
So there's other elements here, and they may not be seeing that. And because they're not going to listen to like a few of, sure, there's some loud voices, some loud consumers that are complaining, myself included, but there's not enough people that are having like, here's the one voice. There isn't really, even though people like to pretend that there's like this big movement against Star Wars, there's really not. There's lots of people that don't particularly like some of the things that they've produced, but the reasons why they don't like them are all over the place.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So there's not this one, like I am the head of the union for people that don't like the current direction of Star Wars. And I'm going to be the spokesman, and I'm going to say, and I represent, you know, hundreds of thousands of people, or maybe millions of people. And here's why we don't like it. And if you don't turn it around, then we're not going to give you our dollars for any of your products that you put out that are Star Wars related, right?
Which, so, again, comes down to the entitlement thing we were talking about.
Well, but that's not entitlement. That's you shouldn't support or buy a product if you don't like it.
It's
that's
the fundamental nature of the consumer.
But
that's not entitlement.
Yeah, but like think about like. And maybe it's just because it's the Star Wars is the example, and it's not something like that's that big of a deal. But like the idea of a union saying, this is what we want the next Star Wars movie to
be.
Well,
no, but I use that as an example because the only way that you can, like, I use that as an example because it doesn't exist. My
point
is it doesn't exist. That if we had a union, if there was, I'm not saying there should be.
Right.
I'm saying if there was a union, then you would be able to have a singular voice, right? But because we don't, it's a whole bunch of voices.
Because art is objectively subjective in that way.
Sure.
Wow.
There's going to be so many different... Or I should say intrinsically subjective.
And one of the things that you get too is that some people will do some things that are, you know, pretty egregious, like the whole issue of chasing the actress for Rose Tico. I forget the actress's name. It was, of course, only a few people that would have done that. And yet that's being considered, okay, this is what these people are like. Well, not really. There's millions of people that didn't like The Last Jedi. That doesn't mean that those are all the people that all think like these few people that are doing, mm-hmm. you know, so it's like there's a real danger there of just assuming that everybody that doesn't like it is also people that might be harassers. That's nonsense. But that's the sort of problems that you get into because there isn't a single voice. There isn't a union that can step up and go, here, I am the spokesman and I will tell you what our people want because I pulled all of them and if they're part of the union, this is what they think and I'm fighting for their, that doesn't exist. And I'm not saying it should, but that's why even when you don't support something with your dollars, then the company comes back and they start scrambling to figure out, okay, what can we do to get them back? And there may not, they may be completely off base.
You
may
make Fallout 78. That's the answer.
Yeah, sure.
77, I think it would be the next
77?
One.
77, sure. You think that would be the next one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Fallout's a great example of that too. People, you've heard a lot of reactions to it that are negative, but certainly people will buy it. Maybe they get a whole new market. Maybe it turns out that's a great game and we all buy it too. To be fair, it's not out yet. We don't know.
Yeah.
But bringing this back into games, I can't say I'm interested in it. It just doesn't seem to me like the Fallout experience that I would expect, or at least the type of game that I would expect. And the type of game that it seems to be, at least on the surface, is the type of game that I don't want to play regardless of whether it's called Fallout or not.
Mm-hmm. And I think that what this kind of gets down to for me too is, you know, like I come away from E3 typically not having this overwhelming feeling of having been sold to because I don't engage with it on their terms. And I know that sounds a little bit odd, but basically like my E3 experience is I watch something I'm interested in, And I granted that, you know, there are a lot of people who are interested in a whole bunch of it or in all of it or whatever the case might be. I actually totally ignore E3 and I watch Nintendo. I've said this before. I watch Nintendo's little thing. I might catch a little bit of their like, you know, treehouse thing they've been doing the last few years. And their approach is typically not let's announce everything we can possibly announce. It's more about let's focus on here's a specific thing we want to talk about.
Here's our launch table for the next year / 2 years.
Yeah, here's our launch table. And also we're going to focus on here's our flagship title that we're talking about this year with Smash Bros. Ultimate.
They do the directs too, right? They have that in
the
directs as
basically
well.
Directs throughout the year too.
Yeah, this was just their E3 direct.
Sure.
And so like for me, I tuned into that and then I saw everyone else around me start commenting and reacting to in various degrees of acceptance or rejection what they saw at E3. And I kind of got enough of the E3 experience by proxy, essentially. And I think too that kind of going back a little bit to my point earlier about having that investment. I think too that, like, you know, I mentioned I'm a Nintendo fan, so in a way, and it's like I don't think it's either a good thing or a bad thing. I am kind of a loyalist to this brand, and so I come to this brand because they've not let me down in any way. Typically, I'm interested in their products. I know what it is that I am not interested in playing from them.
Right.
So I can take everything that they're presenting to me with a grain of salt. Like, okay, yeah. I don't care about those things. Ooh, this looks pretty cool. And then even still, I kind of am able to say, okay, I appreciate this thing. These things might have been better, or I wish they might have done this thing. But it's more just, I don't know. Well, I find, like, that I don't get as passionate about, oh, they should have done this, and I'm angry they didn't do this.
Yeah, and like Nintendo, you know, I'm not going to talk to their, or like, I'm not going to speak to their motivations as a corporation, but at the very least they come
make
across
money.
Well, yes. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously that's their
the corporate execs are thinking along those lines.
But my point is that they don't come across as manipulatively you know, trying to, you know, control their market in a certain way like most other AAA companies have been lately. And maybe that's just because they do things like they'll release a game with maybe one DLC and call it a day, like Zelda or like Super Mario Odyssey. It's just simple stuff that, you know, they're not introducing microtransactions into their games and they're not trying to do everything that they can to milk every cent out of their consumers. Mm-hmm. They're just trying to make good games. And, you know, that's why watching Nintendo Direct, it's easy for you to not, you know, feel the weight of E3 as it is thrust upon you.
I think, and Chris, you, I did want to touch just a little bit on something that you said related to loyalty. And that's something that I feel is kind of one of my issues with this and why I get so passionate about things. Because when I play, I get to the point where I will place my faith into certain creators and certain franchises and certain things where I go, okay, I really like what's being put out, what's being produced. I like how it's handled. Nintendo's one of those for me too. Rockstar, I mentioned. Mm-hmm. And when that trust is betrayed, it feels like, I mean, look at the terminology that I'm using here. I mean, I feel betrayed, even though they don't even know who I am. And yet, because I put that faith into them and I support them in many different ways, and I'm like, I evangelize for them.
You get invested emotionally and monetarily.
Exactly. I become invested. And when I feel that trust is broken, it does hit me like a betrayal. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's probably not the right way to look at these companies, really, or look at these franchises. It's probably not the right way to do it, and yet it's something that I know I'm guilty of. I can, you know, I'm honest enough to admit that, and I feel like that's something that happens with a lot of people, and maybe that's where some of that, you know, entitlement comes into play. It's almost more like, it feels like it's, I wouldn't even use the word entitlement. It almost feels like, you know, you're on their team or you're a supporter of their team, to use like a sports analogy, and so you feel like when they don't perform the way that you think that they can, or they betray the fans or the supporters in some way, you take it personally.
Yeah. And
right?
These corporations are not your friend.
Exactly.
And we have to stop treating them that way.
Well, only the ones that don't deserve to be treated that way. Frankly, I think Nintendo's done a great job in earning our respect and loyalty in that regard.
On the other hand, they still do stuff that's not
but we
perfect.
Keep saying,
so we shouldn't, of course not. We shouldn't be willing. We shouldn't just excuse any bad thing.
No, but that's
not
what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the corporate policy that is specifically out to make money from those rubes, those stupid idiots, the gamers.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that, I think, is more, I think we're at a higher critical level of danger with that attitude than we think we are.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I just think that the solution to that is to stop supporting these, like, you know, the big corporation, the big company.
Predatory practices.
But that's the practices come from the company. That's kind of what I'm getting at. Yes. Same thing with the franchises. And instead, look at the creators behind it. And if mm-hmm. you go, okay, I believe in this creator or this set of creators, or I know that this person that is this group of people that yeah. are working on the game, this team, I know this team that's developing it. Yeah. I have faith in them.
Shame on you, Tim Schafer.
I don't necessarily mm-hmm. have faith. Doesn't mean they can't betray that faith, right? Yeah. But you still go, okay, I have faith in this set of creators or this one visionary or what have you. Even if you don't like the practices of the company that's putting them out, or maybe you do like the practice of that company, but don't latch onto the company and don't latch onto the franchise. Yeah. That's the thing with Star Wars too. Yeah. Why would I ever think that I would like a Star Wars film by J.J. Abrams? I don't like J.J. Abrams. I don't like his stuff.
Exactly.
Because it has the Star Wars name on it. That's the wrong...
Right.
Right from the start, I was setting myself up for failure. Right.
Was George Lucas's vision of Star Wars, whether you realized it or not.
Sure. Yeah. Exactly. So that's kind of what I'm getting at, is to not latch onto the franchise, not just on the name. Look at Star Trek's another great example of that. I say I love Star Trek.
Not the new stuff.
No, I don't. Yeah. But I love lots of other things from Star Trek. Mm-hmm. So I liked Roddenberry's vision, or I liked Brennan, I think is his name, the guy who did DS9 and some, I liked his vision too after Roddenberry was gone. I don't like the new stuff. So it's like, but it's not because it's new. DS9 was very different from the other from Next Generation, from that style. Next Generation itself was different from the original 60s show, and I like all three of those. Yep. So it's more about looking at the creator and not looking at the franchise, not looking at the company.
And that's why I like Bethesda Game Studios.
There you go.
And not Bethesda Softworks.
Yeah, we've come full circle.
Unfortunately, the problem is that in the latest, you know, specifically Elder Scrolls games, we've seen a lot more influence from Bethesda Softworks trying to, you know, re-release Skyrim so many times. And then
now we've come full circle.
Well, that's always going to be the case, and we have to recognize that the people that we latch onto are never going to be the president of the company, right? It's going to be, unless for whatever reason, it's a small enough company that the president just happens to also be the person behind the, you know, the creative force.
Yeah.
That's very rare.
Do you know why Morrowind was the best Elder Scrolls game? Because the company was going to fail if they didn't make a great game.
That happens so many times, honestly, with games. I mean, we could do a whole show about games that were original and inventive and creative.
Because it needed to be.
They were the last. They were the last game the company thought they were going to make before they went under. And you see this a lot in games, and you see it actually. You see it in television and film too. Yeah, frankly, it would be, I think, a really good topic for another show.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
Why that is the key.
And I think too, at the same time, to kind of echo something that we've also said before, you know, we can talk about, like, we find that, you know, we liked this version or this author's vision of a franchise or a series, whatever the case might be. But then there are lots of other people out there who do like, you know, the stuff that we might say, just like corporate shovelware. They legitimately like that.
I like that term, shovelware.
Of course, but
the issue isn't
about, sometimes I like it too.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong.
Oh, yeah, fair.
It's like what Nick was saying with Call of Duty. It was a fun game. Mm-hmm. He liked it, but it wasn't impactful. Mm-hmm.
It
right?
was it's great actually for the mobile version of Westworld, which is a slightly superior game to the Fallout Shelter.
And I think that
there's not much meat there. It's very basic. It's very repetitive. Yeah. And it's totally a mobile game. But there is that underlying element of everything is going to go completely crazy wrong. And you know it is because it's Westworld. And we're building towards it. I'm at the point now where the shareholder meeting is about to happen. And I'm like, are they all going to die? This is going to be great. And I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen. And I'm probably like 30 hours in, which is insane that I've spent that amount of time on my phone.
Wow.
But, you know, I'm enjoying it. And I second screen it while I watch other stuff. Mm-hmm. So there's a place for shovelware.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong.
And I guess my final point there too is that, like, you know, I think that a part of being a critical consumer is recognizing, and we've said this again before, knowing what it is you want out of something, seeing if it gives you that, or at the very least seeing what you can appreciate out of it if you do, and you're free to not. And I think it's also something where we and I'm not saying that anyone here at this table is doing this, but I've sensed like this trend just in general of feeling that other people's opinions on things are wrong or invalid because it doesn't line up with yours.
Right.
And I think that
I feel like that opinion is wrong and invalid.
Fair enough.
There's an empathy element to that. There's a strong empathy element to that, which is straight out of Detroit Become Human. And the idea of being able to connect with someone else in their opinion. Yeah.
Yes. And so holding loosely to the things that you like about something, finding when you do and don't, just be honest with yourself. Like, I do or I don't like this thing. And then totally being open to someone else liking it for the same reasons that you dislike it.
Yeah, there you go.
If I may, I find it interesting that, and I get your point, and I pretty much agree with you, but I find it interesting that you started out that argument of if we are going to be responsible consumers, I feel like that's, again, indicative of the culture that we're in with capitalism in general, but also just like corporate PR and all that.
Yay, capitalism.
We are not just consumers, and we shouldn't be living our lives as, man, how am I going to be a consumer today?
And I do agree with Nick, though, and I've used the word consumer a lot of times during the show, but I don't like that word, and I don't think that at least given the way that we've discussed this topic, I don't think that we're looking at it through the lens of a consumer. We're like, not really, not the way
we're critics.
Right. But
this is a critical show.
And not just critics,
we're game critics.
But also, because critic has this other.
And culture critics.
Almost has a negative connotation to it as well. And we don't mean it that way either. We just mean that we're
critical
more,
thinkers.
Yeah, we're critical. There you go. That's a better way to look at it.
Well, critique might be a better word.
Critique.
You know, I come from an art background.
Yes.
And one of the first things we learned before the technical elements of doing the art was how to give criticism and still be able to talk to each other after the class was over. And that's something that I think has been left out of about a generation of college right now, especially in the humanities. But man, that is a topic for another day.
That would be a great topic.
Yeah, but no, I think I see your point there too, that you know, like, I use the term consumer in sort of a market sense, but then we are also just fans of the thing that we are consuming.
Yeah, right.
It's not just consuming in a sense of like, I made a purchase and therefore I'm a consumer of the product.
It, yeah, and my point in pointing that out was mostly just to call attention to the fact that
I don't
want to just like gloss over the fact that we are just consumers.
We are video game enthusiasts.
Yeah, right? We happen to buy a game at some point, and so we were a consumer for that moment. But then after that transaction is done, what are we? We are just someone who's trying to experience this piece of.
I'm a game spotter.
Media.
Yes. That's me. I'm a game spotter. Yeah, and to point out that the harshest critics of all of some major franchise, like pick your franchise, pick a game franchise or Star Wars or whatever you want. Are the so-called fans?
Oh yeah,
No, I mean fanatics. Going back again, by the way,
the companies both want us to be
the biggest consumers.
Yeah,
no, I mean
these companies both want us to be completely invested in their product and to feel this loyalty and this connection,
and also love it.
Yeah, exactly.
But sometimes they don't want to hear that criticism.
That's another reason why they say all press is good press.
So it's like it's a double-edged sword.
Right.
You get them that passion about your product.
Yes,
and then they're going to be the ones who speak the loudest against it.
Exactly, the people that are speaking out the most about the new Star Wars franchise. These are not people that just are random, never had interest in Star Wars. These are Star Wars super fans. These are fanatics that, like, their whole life has just been, I gotta, you know, buy more Star Wars stuff because I love it so much. They're supporting this, you know, these companies, and they're supporting the franchise when it may not have been popular or cool.
Yeah.
And so, of course, they're going to get really, you know,
deeply
we're
going to
get really deep. Sometimes, I mean, I was deeply offended, frankly, but...
We hadn't noticed.
Right, but at the same time, it's like... You know, whether that reaction, whether, you know, I shouldn't have, whether I was putting my faith in the right thing, I should put it that way, was wrong. I was putting my faith in, say, the brand, the name, and that's the wrong take from the start, because it was never the brand. It was never the name of Star Wars.
It was an auteur experience, and we failed to understand.
So coming truly full circle.
Yes, excellent.
Back to the letter that
we had. How many circles? We're just spinning like a top over here, right?
We've got like this really nice like Venn diagram going on. But going all the way back to our letter about Todd Howard coming out and being the human.
Right.
That is now the face of this company.
Right.
Well, of Bethesda Game Studios. That was his purpose.
Yeah, but point being... That we also have to remember that these are people involved in making this stuff.
That's right.
And like there's that auteur element. There's a whole bunch of different stuff. And ultimately, these people who are working on it, generally, there's some people I'm sure don't care who are just looking very objectively, like, I'm just trying to make money off of this. This is just my job. It pays the bills. But I think a lot of people in game development actually do care about the product they do. And so even if it's not, whether it's not that they're allowed to make what they want to make, or just that there's other limitations, or the direction they choose to go in is different than what other people expect, they ultimately too are fans of this franchise. And so Fallout 76 to a lot of people, I'm sure, sounds like a really cool idea. And like, here's a cool new take on this franchise we love.
Yeah.
Even if it's not what
they're excited. They're more excited to make Fallout 76 than Jim and Doc are to play.
Yeah.
Well, let's put it that way. That's probably true.
And they're probably also, but like, they're under no illusions that it's not a mainline Fallout game.
I also think though that there is a danger in one of the things that you said, because I do, it's definitely not true in film, and I highly doubt, and it's not true in television, and I highly, or books or comics, or, and I highly doubt it's true in video games either, that just because someone is working on the latest iteration of X franchise does not mean that they were ever fans of that franchise.
Sure.
Because
that's very true.
You get assigned, you're at a company, you get assigned, sometimes they bring in someone on purpose that doesn't like it to do something different. Mm-hmm. So I don't
think J.J. Abrams got hired for Star
exactly.
Trek.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So you can't you can't just look at it and go, well, I'm sure they're fans too. No, that's not true. Sometimes they're not. And honestly, sometimes that's the problem.
Yeah.
That's why J.J. Abrams' Star Trek missed the mark. Because you brought in someone that wasn't even a Star Trek fan.
Yeah. You should see the difference in team from Morrowind to Oblivion to Skyrim.
Yeah.
Completely different people making these games.
Now, that being said, of course, I'm not advocating any sort of harassment, of course not. However, criticism, yes.
Yeah.
Criticism, yes.
Yes.
If I say
critique,
if I say this film, this game, this character, whatever it is garbage, is crap, that is a crass criticism, but it's still a criticism, and that's not harassment.
Yeah.
Which is completely different from nerd rage.
Yes.
Stow the nerd rage.
Yes.
So
you could be critical of a creator directly and say, I don't like what you said, I didn't like what you did here, etc. But that doesn't mean, that's not, that also, you know, that's not that's not harassment.
Well, the point being is that it's not simple. None of this is simple.
No, it
is.
Of course.
And so, like, when we come down to even just the question of, is it X or is it Y? And I said, I think it's both. I think it's a person who is working for a corporation, understanding the realities of the business, but also wanting to, you know, like, they have some pride in their company and what they do.
That I agree with too.
And so
they're making something that they like, just like J.J. Abrams made a Star Trek film that he would like.
Yes. Well, it would not be a birthday episode if we didn't mention this. So in honor of Richard, I say this: No Man's Sky is worth giving a second chance.
What?
Because
actually, yeah,
because they have rolled out a huge patch, a massive, massive patch that has brought it closer to the original pitch and the original vision than ever before. And I've said this before, and I will say it again: if they had simply said, "This is the alpha," and you're paying for pre-access,
you're praying too.
If
they had simply not signed on with a giant corporation who rushed them into making a game that they wasn't
that
finished,
that I think all would have been forgiven, and that they would be sitting in a very different place right now. I think they would be the so-called new Minecraft in that spiritual sense, not in the mechanical sense, maybe a little bit in the mechanical sense, in the going and getting materials. But all of that is to say, if you have not tried it recently, like in the last year, give it a download again and give it a try. You already paid for it. Just, you know, it's not going to hurt you any. And see if it has changed any. You know, hop over to a new world and let it generate for you, and just see what's there for you. You may be incredibly surprised.
I actually had a pretty good time playing No Man's Sky a couple weeks ago.
I know. So anyway, that's nothing to do with E3, but you know, that was the topic of the game that we talked about in our very, I say we, I wasn't even in that episode, in our very first episode. So happy birthday, guys.
Closing the 4-year circle.
Yeah. Closing the real
circle. And now we need to, please close the show so we can stop.
I was about to say, now we need to close the circle of the show. So,
and now
happy birthday.
Put us out of our misery, please.
I need to think of some bigger circles to close.
Yes. Thank you, everyone, for joining us for episode 132 of the Backward-Compatible.com podcast, our discussion on E3, ? Anyway, I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
I'm Doc.
And I'm a communist. I'm not actually a communist.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to write into the show, because dialogue makes everyone better. If you want to comment on this episode, ask a question, share some info, voice an opinion, or request a topic, send an email to inbox at backward
roleplaying-compatible.com, and we may feature you on a future episode of the podcast. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible. Backward compatible.